Jackie, could you
Yes.
tell me how many homes would be allowed under a medium density?
Sure. So let me do a little bit of quick math here. Don't have to do it on the screen. So we've got 44 and then some acres, so 44.07. What we usually say is about 20% is for utilities or roadways. So I'm going to subtract out 20% here. And divide that by 0.21. So if this was medium density at 0.21, that would allow for up to 167 individual lots after removing areas for 20% for basically roads and utilities.
Okay, thank you. Do other members of the Plan Commission have any questions for Jackie? If there are none, we'd like to hear from the petitioner or the petitioner's representative.
I know that they do have a PowerPoint that they're hoping to present. Is
Good
Kevin,
evening.
Yeah, or Donnie? Okay.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Donnie Good Atkins. Evening. Thank you, Jackie, for everything you've done up to this point and for running the slides for us. We'd like to introduce ourselves to everyone and can't say enough how much we appreciate all the effort that's been put in by the planning team up to this point to get us here. We've got a really exciting opportunity and development that we're looking forward to taking you through it, introducing ourselves to you, and of course, receiving any feedback that you might have. Jackie, if you could go to the next slide, please. So since Kevin and I are new to these meetings, we thought it'd be good to quickly introduce ourselves. And we'll start with myself real quick. I graduated from IU in 2001 and then entered the Air Force. Since then, after 6 years in the military, I've been with a major energy firm and conducted and managed projects all over the world to date. Kevin as well doesn't have the exact educational pedigree that I do with IU, but he's still got a great degree too. And his introduction to IU is through his wife's parents, where they met back in 1968. So we both got some very solid links to Bloomington and IU. And we're so looking forward to taking on this endeavor in Monroe County. Next, we wanted just to quickly touch on our inspiration. And we both got young families. And as I mentioned, going to IU and spending so much of my life in Monroe County, I have been looking forward to an opportunity to get back to Bloomington and to raise my family there. And you can see a few snapshots. That's my daughter when she was 6 months old at the NCAA tournament. And from since at least that time, she's known she's going to be a Bloomington resident and hopefully a Hoosier. And then you can see my kids as well there in the middle picture when I caught them behind the waterfall at Cascades Park. So, you know, Bloomington and Monroe County has been a big part of our lives even to date, even though we aren't residents yet. And I'll get to that in a minute. And then Jacob and Chloe, which are Kevin's children, are both love the outdoors as well and really will appreciate Bloomington and Monroe County as well. If you want to go to the next slide, Jackie. So we've talked a little bit about the need for housing, not just in the United States, but especially in Bloomington, Monroe County, and how challenging it's been. And I myself, as I mentioned, started looking for a house for my family back in the summertime. And it was incredibly difficult. Anything that was decent under $400,000 was going in less than a few days, if not within a few hours of it listed. And so, you know, to make sure we're all clear on the business case, we pulled the data from the National Association of Realtors, and we've got it listed there, right there, that of how challenging the situation is for middle class and young families in Monroe County. Per the National Association of Realtors, 6 months is what a good balance is for housing availability. And back in December, you can see what the actual timeframes were by the different prices of homes. And these are incredibly, you know, make it incredibly, number one, hard to find a house, and also, of course, increase the price escalations very quickly. And that's what we've seen, double digit, you know, increases in housing prices over the last 12 months, which have challenged, of course, families even more to attain a house. This data has gotten even more challenging if we look at the latest stats since December, where these numbers have gotten even shorter and the supply even more dire. And so our goal is to help solve this problem for Monroe County by providing middle-class families high quality and attractive, attainable homes. You know, this property right now is currently zoned a rural estate. And, you know, we seek to change that because we're not going to solve any of the problems by just building more, you know, close to $1 million acre lots. And so our goal is to build and develop a gorgeous, beautiful neighborhood in an incredible area of Monroe County, adjacent to the trails, near the school, and, you know, with the public utilities, you know, just as the comprehensive plan would like us to do so. So this is an incredible opportunity. I'm going to hand it over to Kevin, and he's going to take you through more of the specifics. Thanks again, everyone, for your time.
Thanks, Donnie. So yeah, if I just, while we're on this slide, I think a few other pieces, and I know Jackie did a great job of introducing this this neighborhood. You know, some of the really focus on is strong connection to the environment. And, you know, we really like the idea of the way this neighborhood is going to be laid out, you know, with rolling hills, and really a natural, unique neighborhood feel that's going to be very akin to a lot of the neighborhoods that have been built throughout the years in Bloomington. You know, this land is about as far south as you can get with access to city utility infrastructure. Which is why, as Donnie mentioned, this really does align, and the density we're looking for really does align with the comprehensive plan intent. So there's, you know, as it lays right now, it's a farm, it's a hay field. So there's really minimal surface environmental disruption. You know, this is not a place where we're going into a huge forested area and destroying a lot of trees. We're talking about building on existing farmland that is currently used for hay. So very, very minimal disruption. If you can go to the next slide, Jackie, thank you. So, you know, Jackie talked a little bit about this, a development plan, a PUD, you know, to develop anywhere between 140 and 160 homes. The current layout is 145, as Jackie correctly said. You know, built in three phases. We really are looking at the attainable housing, really high quality attainable housing. And you know, we've talked a little bit about this, but, you know, diversity of offerings we think is really, really important. You know, we've spent a lot of time living in a lot of different places around the world, and bringing that back to the Bloomington area, the idea of diverse offerings, single family homes, paired patio homes, and townhomes with different lot sizes, and the flexibility to have those different lot sizes all in a neighborhood really does bring a community together. And I think, you know, we've shown over the last year with what's gone on in COVID, et cetera, that bringing a community together is really, really important. And, you know, you are who you are in the community with. So I think that's, you know, that's what we really want to bring here. We, you know, based on the PUD, there are some unique attributes that we're going to be doing that, you know, our neighborhood will have some parks and a few other things. So moving on to the next slide is the diversity of offerings. Again, we've talked about, this is just a few examples of some of the houses we'd be building. Single family homes on your left, paired patio homes, and then, you know, a depiction of what a townhome might look like. And again, the idea on the townhomes, and I'll talk, just touch a little bit on it right now, was this was when we first started approaching this with Bloomington, you know, some of Bloomington's best people. So Bynum and Fanyo, you know, Mike Carmen, and we started talking with the planning committee, the planners. One of the things they said to us was, we really like Dodd Street. We really like the way that they took density and put it around the trail, and they made leverage and access to the trails. So that was sort of where the genesis of the idea of the townhomes came from, was from that that initial interaction. Jack, you can go to the next slide. So this is I think a pretty cool idea, but you know, we talked a little bit about it in that northeast corner. You know, one of the things that we've done was taken that area that is a little bit more forested and has a few more trees. And we've said, we're not going to build houses there. We're going to try and look at a way to build something that will make this neighborhood unique. And, you know, looking at the trail infrastructure that the city and county have spent so much time and money on and really get leveraged and used so much, we said, well, let's build a really cool adventure park up near the trail. So this was an idea that we would have something.
Unmute your speaker to increase the volume to hear other participants.
Sorry, this is something that the idea was that we would have something here that was accessible for the not only the neighborhood, but also the community that uses those trails so frequently. Jackie, if you can just click to the next slide. So this is a view from the bottom side. This is an over kind of a bird's eye view. And if I can just kind of run you through from bottom right to top left, the idea was in the bottom right area, there would be some high adventure areas, again, focusing on the nature side of this, a very natural build, using the trees, leveraging that, a BMX park that would have ramps that run through trails, dirt trails. And then as you come up to the top left, there would be a young kids park, like an infants and small child park up to the top left, where it says lawn, there would be a little bit of an adventure park there, just a smaller park. And then where the lawn is and kind of a big gazebo area for just people to hang out and again, enjoy the community that we envision. So again, something that we is not required, but something that we think is a really cool attribute. You know, again, we talked about this and, you know, kind of staying in tune with what's going on in the world, you know, dog parks, community gardens are really, really important for people. So again, not something that we're required to do, but something that we really think is useful for the community and will really be a key interest for the neighborhood and also for the people using the trail. So, you know, a natural dog park that allows people to go and socialize and be outside. Same thing with the community garden, helps teach and really emphasizes the idea of connecting back with the land. So the, you know, we talked a little bit about our connection with the land and, you know, Donnie and myself are both very, very akin to understanding what, you know, what impacts things have and what we're doing and how we can best manage the development and leverage the unique attributes of this site. So we've done a lot of environmental surveys. I think we'll talk a little bit more about drainage. We've looked for wetlands. We've done some karst feature identification. And again, those karst features are all really concentrated up in the northeast corner where there isn't any housing development. We've done an environmental phase one, and we really do believe that this plan minimizes site disruption. So throughout this process, we've had the opportunity to meet with a lot of the neighbors, something that's been really exciting for us, you know, meeting with the people that are in this area. And, you know, I think you'll notice that there's a number of remonstrances that a lot of people have put in information about how they, you know, things that they don't like or things that they don't like about the development. I would just mention that a lot of those were probably before we had conversations with them. And a lot of them were, I think, maybe misinformation and pieces of information that they were not fully developed or shared at the time. And so we've had three or four meetings with individual neighbors and with groups of neighbors to try and clarify those details as much as possible. So I'll just walk through maybe what the three or four big topics were coming out of those neighborhood meetings. And just show that really what we're doing in this is actually going to potentially help some of their concerns, not hurt their concerns. So drainage is probably the first one, the major one. So current site runoff flows uncontrolled. There is no drainage system involved in this hayfield at all. And as people have mentioned, as this is the current situation, there has been flooding in the area. The design of our development will reduce runoff by more than 75%. We actually, latest numbers are about 80%, and this will clean and filter the outflow, right? So we're reducing the runoff off this site after this is built by 75 to 80%. The downstream effects of site runoff will be reduced, which means that there will be less flooding downstream than if undeveloped. And we are committed to all of the requirements for the critical watershed area. In fact, we've just gone through the drainage board meeting and received approval on our preliminary drainage plans. So we've had the luxury of working with not only the county drainage team, but also Bonham and Fanyo, and really been supported by a great team. The second, I think, concern was related to traffic. So we have shared plans with the Public Works Department and the Highway Engineer. Paul's been a very, very big asset for us. And we've gone back and forth a number of times, incorporated his feedback. And based on that, Jackie, if you can go to click next slide. You can see here, you can see here there, that's the planned upgrade for the entrance to the neighborhood. And that planned upgrade has been approved by Paul and has been approved by the Public Works Department and by the County of Monroe. So it's all something that we've, again, taken that feedback, understood, and that neighborhood design really does encourage alternate transportation. So this is one thing that, you know, probably doesn't get addressed enough, is because of the access to the trails and the location, we really do believe that this is going to be something that people are going to be able to use the alternate transportation, biking to work, walking to work, going out and leveraging this area. That's going to be really, really great. Jackie, next slide. Another major concern that we heard throughout our conversations with the neighbors was tree removal. And again, I think this was just something that we wanted to set the record straight on and make sure that people understand, because I think there's a lot of misunderstandings. So we are committed to preserving all trees where possible. We are only going to be getting rid of essentially trees that we need to. Currently, our site has 350 plus trees, and we estimate that development will require removal of approximately or less than 100 trees. We also believe that the development plans will yield planting between 200 and 300 trees at a minimum, which means that when we're done with this, we will have 50% more trees on the site than we did originally. And you can see that northeast corner, there is no disturbance of the trees planned up there. It's only in and around the area where the existing farmhouse is and some of those in that area there. And I think the other key here is that, you know, there's been some talk about large trees versus small trees when we plant them. And I think, you know, really, again, this neighborhood is about sustainability for the future. So if we're putting in all of this information, we're going to have trees that are going to grow to, you know, greater, much greater development throughout the future. Jackie, if you can go to the next slide. And then the final thing that I've heard, you know, we've heard talked about a number of times was the density and people making the assessment that the density in this area was not akin to the area. So again, if we look at all the areas that are accessible through current utilities, which is storm sewer, water, and public utilities, these are neighborhoods surrounding that area. And you can see that the neighborhoods surrounding this area, we're proposing a 3.6 lot per acre density. And if you look at the densities associated with the neighborhoods around this area, we are exactly slightly below the average of the neighborhoods around this area. So, you know, the average around this area is 3.7 lots per acre. And we really believe that this is exactly what the planning board is looking for. The density of the trails is lower than the comprehensive plan and the future CDO. So the comprehensive plan and future CDO, which I think Jackie just mentioned, allowed for 167 lots, and we're proposing up to maximum of 160. You know, there's some notable county neighborhoods like Highlands Park Estates that is currently 4.3 lots per acre. And again, that's a higher density than we're currently suggesting. So. And the other benefit that you can see here is that those yellow lines, the trail is really a constraint around the surrounding neighborhoods, and it really does allow us to leverage those trails on the southern side of this property. Jackie, if you can go. And then the final thing that we've heard and just wanted to address was why a PUD. So I think Donnie and I are somewhat new to this in Monroe County. And so we spent a lot of time reading the zoning ordinances. And when we came across chapter 811 that talks about PUDs, it really seemed like it was the right answer. So again, just reading some of those details, is PUD is used to encourage flexibility in development and promote the most appropriate use. And these are just some quotes out of chapter 811. It encourages a harmonious an appropriate mixture of uses, which I think is exactly what we're going for with the paired patio homes, townhomes, and single family, trail density versus interior lower density, encourages to provide a mechanism for arranging improvements on site so as to preserve desirable features. So again, I think we really spent a lot of time talking about that northeast corner where there's a ton of areas for education. We've committed to putting some signs up and talking with the drainage board about environmental learning, you know, teaching people about what is a karst, what does a wetlands mean? What are some of the endangered species in the area? And this PUD allows us to do that. And then reflect on the policies of the comprehensive plan. So, you know, really, like I said, this based on what the comprehensive plan is suggesting, this is exactly what we're doing. So that sort of facilitates what we're looking for, the community parks. It allows us to have trail access, different density in different areas, and size and layouts of the lots, which again, we think is very advantageous to the benefit of the community.
Thank you, Mr. Schmidt.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Appreciate your time.
And if, is there any other member of your petitioner team who would like to speak with us?
Mary, this is Mike Carmen. Just a couple of comments. I want to address more response to the staff report and Jackie's comments earlier regarding not the PUD, but a different, what she called a by right zoning development. Because when I read the staff report and I saw the recommended denial based on findings, I read through the findings and I frankly struggled to find what were the findings that would lead you to a denial. Actually, I couldn't find it. There were a couple of comments, and I want to read that. We all had the chance to watch your earlier meetings, and there's ongoing discussion about this commercial use issue and the mixed residential. So I'm not going to dwell on that. You've already aired that issue quite a bit, but I do want to go back to the source document. And as I read the urbanizing area in the comp plan and the reference to the mixed residential area, the statement is not that commercial uses are required. The statement is they, meaning the mixed residential areas, may also include neighborhood commercial uses as a local amenity. It's an option. In fact, it's really, as I read it in the plan, it's offered as an incentive or an inducement to allow some further development in mixed use, but certainly not as a requirement. The mixed residential use is met in what Kevin just went through in some detail, the different components and the type of housing. It's not a cookie cutter, one size fits all checkerboard structures to go in there. So I would submit that the plan is supportive of what they're trying to do. And as you've dealt with sliding scale zoning and on the sliding scale subdivision issues, arguments about keep the rural, and you know the promise of the urbanizing area was to push the development into that area and to as a means to keep from sprawling out in the county more into the more rural areas, and it's working. As I think you're seeing that now. You've seen it with some other petitions. You're seeing it here. It is having that. I understand there are people that live in this area that have been there for many years. I suspect some of them have been there long before bachelor school was built. I mean, the neighborhood is changing. The city is pushing out. The urbanizing area is a recognition by the county and the comp plan that there's the donut around the corporate limits of the city that is going to be that area where you want the more intense development. And this is part of that area. The negative I heard from Jackie in her comments regarding the denial was to do by right zoning would change over time as the code changes, standards change, and that a PUD won't do that. Once it's there, it's always going to be there. Well, actually, that's true for a by right zoning in a subdivision plat as well. Once the plat is built out, you don't go back and knock down houses and say you have to rebuild these because our code has changed now. You have to come into compliance. Once it's built out, it's there forever. And I just don't see that as an issue to say no PUD, because otherwise it sounded like the staff had no problem with the density, with the development. It was, let's just do it under a by right zone as opposed to PUD. And there are reasons why, as Kevin has highlighted, why the PUD works better. And it takes nothing away from what the by right zone would have allowed. It takes nothing away, but it adds some nuances and some flexibility that, as Kevin has detailed those. You know, if the concern for getting current code was all that strong. I don't know why we've been living with Chapter 33 in the ordinance for all these years since 1998, when the city reluctantly but did hand it back to all those areas, back to the county for administering the zoning ordinance. Because for all these years, since 98, you've administered the city zoning code over all those areas that came back from out of the fringe area and back into your control. There has been no push to, we got to update the code on those areas. We got to rezone them into county zones so they're consistent with everything else we do. You've administered the city code on these more than 20 years on those lots, and it certainly is workable. And the staff has managed to do that. And we'll submit that the PUD falls in that same area. It's not quite a by right zoning. It's very close to it. By right use is within the straight zone, the MR or HR, which we think would be the more appropriate. The density is even less than what the calculation Jackie gave you earlier, and would submit that it's on all squares with the comp plan as you've talked about it for the urbanizing area, and would certainly like to see it implemented here. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Carman. And you raised some very interesting points, and I'd like to ask Mr. Schilling a question. Because this discussion of by right and the comprehensive plan, et cetera, I'd like to know from the county attorney's perspective, if the comprehensive plan is just one of many factors that we should consider when we are approving proposals, that we should also consider current conditions and the character of current structures and also the most desirable use for the land and responsible development and growth. And so, Mr. Schilling, would you please be so kind as to weigh in on that?
Well, I think you summarized it well, Margaret, that those are the factors that you consider when you're dealing with PUD ordinances.
Thank you, Mr. Schilling. And so we've heard from the petitioner. Oh, Mr. McKim, I'll defer to you before moving on.
Oh, yes, I had a couple of quick questions for the petitioner's representatives. I guess I'll address since Mr. Carman just spoke, I'll address this one. And I appreciate your passionate defense of the PUD. I do agree that it is in keeping with the comprehensive plan. And, you know, I think in general, the current low density of this property is not appropriate for the future of the area. But I still don't really understand, other than the fourplexes, what can you actually not do with a rezone that you want to do versus a PUD? I get that the fourplexes are going to be an issue, but that aside, is there anything else that you want to do that a rezone to a county zone would not allow you to do?
Mike, you're on mute.
You're on mute, Mr. Carman.
Sorry, I was still muted. Apologize. Yeah. Did you want to answer that? If not, I'll. It will. Okay.
Yeah, right. Go ahead, Mike.
Back to Jeff. I'm sorry. Jeff, the fourplexes is the primary one. That's true, because that's a housing option that's not otherwise available in any zone. You've seen what's going on in the city now with the plexes and that issue and the controversy that has trying to shoehorn plexes into already built and established neighborhoods. A lot of pushback, and they dealt with that again the other night. They're going to deal with it over the next several weeks and getting to the council. Here we have the opportunity to do that in a newly built neighborhood, not shoehorn it into an existing one where you have problems with off-street parking and road width and those things. So to have that flexibility, now staff has pushed back on that a little bit, but there's no space where you're actually committed to say this is what it will be here. And that's intentional, because despite best efforts at planning, when you've got a development of this size, the number of units involved, it will be reactive to the market too, on where those will be, how many of them, and will it be. It was very reluctant to make a firm commitment on nailing those down to a particular lot or particular lots in a particular part of the project, because as this builds out over several years, you saw the three phases, there's a real issue trying to maintain flexibility to deal with what is the market demand. If 3 years now, the whole concept of plexes and the smaller homes and packed a little bit closer together has died out, and the market has said nobody wants them, And we don't want to be in a position of having forced our way into committing to those. We need to keep flexibility. If that market is really strong on those and they really do well, and that's what people end up looking for, which we think there's some, it's hard to gauge how many, they will have the flexibility to do more than what we might have otherwise planned for. So that is a real issue. And that's the other things that have a little bit to do with tweaking some of the development standards about the green space, where it's located and how it's calculated. Some of the dedicated open space, the access to the trails is a little bit easier in the PUD, how that is on those frontage lots compared to straight zoning. But the real issue is the plexus, yes.
Mr. McKinney, if I might add, just also as Mike was describing, that the various sizes of the lots becomes difficult, and managing the different density in different areas of the neighborhood becomes difficult. It is possible and achievable under an HR rezone. However, the PUD, as Mike just described, really offers the flexibility to do that.
Thank you.
Thank you both.
And I'm sorry, I guess, may I ask the other question that I had?
Yes, of course.
This is about the, just about the park amenities, which I really kind of cool. To what degree would they be restricted to residents of the neighborhood versus the public at large?
Yeah, great question. Jackie, could you just go back to the park real quick on that slide? Is that possible? Sorry, just have it up while we're talking about it. Perfect. So, so great question. So I think the idea is that you can see on that bottom left, right above the word trails, there's an entrance directly from the trail. The idea is that this is as much a park for the people on the trail as it is a park for the people in the neighborhood. We have even gone as far as to be willing to, turn this over to the city if that's something that they have desire to do. We are more than willing to hear with the Parks and Rec Service and, hey, we think that this type of area needs this type of park. This is our idea. This is what we've, surveying some people in the area and coming up and engaging local landscape architects, some of the best in Bloomington. This is what we've come up with, but we are very flexible on this and really see this as a huge asset to the overall community in the area, and happy to share it with everyone.
Thank you for the answers.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And I'd like to follow up, since you brought it up, a few questions about homeowners association responsibility. Would they be responsible for the maintenance of the park if the city does not take it over, number one? And and number two, would homeowners association be responsible for drainage? So thank you.
Yes, ma'am. So the answer is yes to both questions. The HOA, which would be run by the developers until set time, say 80% of lots are sold, would be responsible for managing the entire park system and the drainage system. Now, if I can just add a little bit onto that, so that we'll make sure that obviously HOAs, if you set them up appropriately at the beginning and manage them appropriately, they're very well managed, can be very well managed, as long as they're well funded and the understanding of the neighborhood is from the beginning, right? I've had very good experiences with many HOAs. Had bad experiences with some, of course, but very many good experiences. And as far as the drainage, not only will the neighborhood be responsible for managing but we will also provide an O&M manual to the county and the drainage board, and they have the ability to facilitate that management as well. But yes, the HOA is responsible and will be responsible. Okay. We are happy to look at ways to increase that responsiveness and willing to have, whether it's certain members attend HOA meetings or be on the HOA to help facilitate and ensure that maintains into the future.
If a child is injured and permanently maimed in the park, would the homeowners association and therefore the residents become responsible for the liability of that child's injury?
So not the residents. I'll let Mike, but HOAs have their own liability insurance, but I'll let Mr. Carman detail that out more. He's a lawyer, so.
Okay. Margaret, the HOA will maintain insurance for a number of things, but that would liability insurance would be part of that to cover that. Individual homeowners, I really can't see a legal theory that would make them responsible for an injury or something like that in the park. The law of what we call premises liability, it depends on who has responsibility for maintenance and what was the nature of the injury, a defective condition, was it just recreational play that resulted in an injury? There are a lot of questions on this. I'm not going to say that who's going to necessarily going to be liable, but certainly the HOA would have the responsibility and there'd be insurance maintained by that for those kind of eventualities, yes.
What would happen if the homeowners association failed to pay the insurance premium? Then what would happen?
I would certainly hope that all the lot owners would be up in arms about it, but that's, I don't mean to be glib about it. I don't have a good answer for that because it is responsibility. Members of the board of directors would certainly be, I believe, exposed for liability as malfeasance as directors to not maintain the insurance. So,
yeah. Okay. So with responsibility on the HOA comes some of that type of responsibility.
Okay, thank you. So I think we've heard from the petitioner. Do other members of the commission have questions for the petitioner?
I don't see any, Margaret.
Okay, then we can
go. I'm sorry, I'm on my phone, so it's a bit tricky for me to raise my hand or notice if anyone else was. I guess my question to the petitioner is he kept making the statement, we don't have to do this, we're not, under any obligation to do this several different times. So I'm kind of curious, since the staff is recommending more of a rezone approach, do you still plan to maybe add some of these amenities and features? I mean, it felt like I was almost at a negotiation where like you're adding all this benefit only if it moves forward as a PUD. So if that isn't what happens today, do you plan to kind of submit something that isn't going to have those features like the park? I thought that thing was amazing, like to turn it into an educational type, a gathering area. So I just want to ask that question.
Sure, John. So I think fair enough. That was not the intent to turn it into a negotiation, but I think, there is with added flexibility in a PUD comes additional requirements, and those requirements we've laid out in the PUD. The short answer to your question is yes, we plan on doing these somewhat regardless. The PUD does actually facilitate being able to do all of what we plan to do from the amenity standpoint.
Perfect, thank you. I appreciate you addressing that.
Yep.
Thank you. Well, I think it's time to turn to members of the public. And if there are members of the public who are in favor of this petition, we request that you raise your hand and limit your comments to 3 minutes.
I'm not seeing anyone that's wanting to speak in favor.
Okay. Well, if there are members of the public.
Sorry, Tracy, you have your thumbs up. Did you want to speak in favor? She's on mute. Andy Walker has his hand raised. Oh, Tracy. Okay, Tracy, you want to speak in favor?
I do.
Okay, go ahead.
I said this earlier about another project that was here close to Eagle View, just talking about a need for housing. And it is just such a critical need. And I think they've already shown there's enough infrastructure of that. Well, not really infrastructure, so to speak, but there's a lot of businesses, a lot of activity here, a lot of schools, a lot of people in this area already to attract even more. And it's a great place to live down in this section of town. And it's kind of an untapped resource here. But I want to share with you a little bit of data since you guys shared some data earlier and felt like it was really important. I just wanted to share some information with you from the Indiana Association of Realtors and from the state, our state association and NAR, the National Association. So, in comparing January to March 23rd, last year, 2020, to year to date, 2021, The average list price in Bloomington, Monroe County, increased by $37,688, so a little over $37,000. The average sold price increased by $40,635. The average sold price went from a little over $244,000 to $284,000. The median price increased from $209,000 to $244,000. So that's a difference of $35,000 from this time last year to this year. That's about $11,000 per month. And so at that kind of rate, if we continue to see that kind of rate this year, that could be an increase in a median home price of over $125,000 by the end of the year this year. We've seen that quick of a turn in demand for housing and such a low inventory for it just in the last several months. And I think right now we're just in March, we're not even into the peak season yet. And based on those numbers, we've seen that that's a 21.2% increase in our average sales price. It's 14.8% in our median. The average days on the market has increased or has decreased from last year to this year. The average list price, if you want to just look at Bloomington and take Ellettsville out of it, because there's so much growth and it's a lot more affordable in Ellettsville, you're looking at a median price shift of $40,000 of increase in this first 3 months of the year versus 2020 versus 2021. That's $40,000. To me, that says we have a real need for housing in this community, a serious need for housing. There's 119 active listings in Bloomington, quite a few of those. I was trying to get the numbers of how many of those are in Ellettsville, but 38 are pending right now. And so far, we've sold 333 houses year to date in 2021. It's about 111 per month so far. And we right now have 119. So that's less than a month's supply of housing.
Thanks, Tracy. So, I'm sorry to cut you off. We've got a long list of agenda items. So that was your 3 minutes.
All right.
Thank you.
I think you got the point.
Is there anyone else who would like to speak in favor of this petition?
Excuse me, Margaret. This is Anne. In the chat, there is a Guy Loftman that would like to speak.
I think Guy Loftman wants to speak in opposition.
Well, thank you both. We'll turn to those opponents in just a minute. We'd like to finish with those in favor. Is there anyone else in favor?
I'm not seeing anyone, Margaret.
If there's not, if Mr. Loftman would like to speak, if someone could help unmute him, please limit your comments to 3 minutes.
I'm Guy Loftman. I live at 4835 South Victor Pike, right next door to the Robertson's Farm. I've been here for 45 years. I oppose 2012 PU006. I agree with the historic preservation board concerns that this is loss of farmland, burden on historic roadways such as Victor Pike, that road in Church Lane, and threatens flooding of historic downstream sites. The tree preservation plan that was just shown, which is not part of the package and which I've asked and never gotten, says that they will destroy all the trees except those in that one little northeast corner. That's what it says they will do. Now they're saying, oh, we might not. The traffic study for Southern Meadows shows 142 eastbound cars at the Rogers stop sign on that road on February 2nd at rush hour for an hour. That will go up 50% if they put in 145 units, and tonight's the first time I've ever heard they want to do 160. The pond at the south side is going to drain 24 acres into that pond. To get 24 acres into that pond, if it's sort of a cone-shaped pond like these detention areas are, if that's a 1 acre pond to contain 24 acres, it's going to have to be 6 feet deep just to control 1 inch of rain. At 3 inches of rain, it's going to have to be as 18 feet deep. Ms. Tetonia, Kelsey Tetonia, at the Stormwater Drainage Board meeting said, you remember 2019, February 7th, 2019, where no stream water infrastructure is going to hold that water. That was 5.5 inches. The stormwater coordinator says, we can't hold water like fell 2 years ago. I'm asking you to vote no, because no, in large part because we know that the drainage plan won't work. So please vote no if it is approved tonight. Please don't waive the second hearing. I do want to add that the staff has been very helpful and thorough, and I appreciate all their cooperation. And I want to say Zoom is wonderful for these meetings because it makes it practical for me to attend and when it otherwise wouldn't be. And regardless of how you vote, how you guys can sit through this week after week is amazing and heroic. Yeah. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Loffman. We have Erica Morris next and then Dave Bush.
Yes, thank you. I'm a resident on Victor Pike and I wanted to speak out against in opposition to this. There's several things that have concerned me about what was shared tonight. One, when we first had a neighborhood meeting, it was shared that these would be homes that were affordable in the $200,000 range. With lumber prices alone, that's not achievable. And now we're hearing affordable middle-class homes. Well, what people consider as middle class has a broad range. The other thing that's concerning too is there is a lot of excitement about these parks. And from when we first visited and we talked to that, there are no parking spaces allotted within the neighborhood for people from the community to visit. If this is going to be a community park, there should be parking spaces as done at, you know, the Sherwood Oaks Park or any of the other neighborhood community parks. But that's not really permitted because there's just not space for it. You know, we're hearing how this is a beautiful rolling property too. Yes, it is a beautiful rolling property, but it'll be a rolling property of solid homes and there will be no beauty to the rolling hills anymore. To go back to the parks, can someone clarify exactly how many acres are allotted to that? And also clarify, is that in a floodplain? Because what you're proposing and showing is great, but I'm not really sure that it's achievable in the amount of space that you've allotted for it. It's really kind of pie in the sky, appealing dreams, but you know, a dog park and community lots and all of this in an acre, 2 acres, that might not really be achievable to add any value to it. You've also talked about the homeowners association, and I've had many experiences with this. By and large, it takes a strong governing body. And there is no way for the developers to guarantee a strong governing body once they turn it over. Additionally, the fees are also very important. I lived in a middle-class neighborhood where the fees were $1,500 a year. For that type of fee, we had a pool house, we had a walking trails, which were quite extensive, miles and miles. We had a playground. Numerous amenities. This doesn't have a pool. This doesn't have that type of amenities. So what is a reasonable charge to maintain all of this and ensure it doesn't become a county enforcement issue? The county has expressed earlier that they don't have the staffing to deal with enforcement. So this should not become a burden upon us when the developers have made their money, they've left the mark on Bloomington without respect to the surrounding neighborhood and the impact to the community. Thank you.
Thank you. And the next person, Jackie?
Mr. Dave Bush, and then following that, Kelsey Tetonia, the MS4 coordinator, does have some comments that we'd like to share regarding drainage. So Dave, great. Why don't you go ahead?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Jackie. And a point of order before I begin, I know Patty and I are signed in together, but I believe she would like to reserve 3 minutes for her contribution as well. So anyway, I'm Dave Bush. I've lived at 1250 West Church Lane, the 16 plus acre parcel directly south of the proposed development. We've lived at this property for over 21 years, and during this time, seen a marked increase in the number of flood events, as well as an increase in the severity of the flooding. And I'd like to thank the petitioner for showing the housing density slide of the area, because I think that illustrates the point I'm trying to make, that much of this increase is due to the housing developments being built upstream of our farm. These developments were built in the late 1990s and early 2000s. Most of them predated the Monroe County Stormwater Ordinance. They were not required to construct detention or retention basins to manage stormwater runoff rates, which combined with the high density of homes and impervious surfaces created a situation where stormwaters enter Clear Creek watershed at a much quicker rate than when these areas were farm fields or woodlands. The petitioners have repeatedly stated that they have detention ponds and that these ponds will reduce the rate at which stormwaters enter Clear Creek. This is only partially correct, as their detention ponds are designed to withstand up to a 100-year flood event. Anything greater than a 100-year event will overload their ponds and deliver an even greater stormwater runoff into Clear Creek, because once building is completed, the land will have a much higher percentage of impervious surfaces. As Guy mentioned at the March 17th Drainage Board meeting, Kelsey Thetonia, the Monroe County Stormwater Quality MS4 coordinator, stated, quote, "We do not design infrastructure for more than a 100-year flood. And I think that this is a great step to start addressing these more intense rain events. We're not going to be designing more than the Q100 though, because that is, I mean, it's going to take so much space to be able to store that much water. There is no infrastructure that is going to be able to hold a 500-year event. It's just not going to happen." You remember 2019, February 7, 2019, where no stream water infrastructure is going to hold that water. It's not practical, end quote. So why are the petitioners asking for approval of a design that will not handle the flooding we had just 2 years ago? Why would the county approve this variance to allow a high density development to be shoehorned into this location? Placing it here at the confluence of Clear Creek and West Clear Creek virtually guarantees more frequent and severe flooding for this part of the county. This is our ask of you. Don't make things worse by approving this petition. Abide by the existing RE1 zoning. And thank you all for your time.
Thank you. And Patty, if you're there, could you
begin? I am. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for spending so much time with all of us. My name is Patty Bush. I live at 1250 West Church Lane, the 16 plus acre parcel directly south of the proposed development. Perhaps you'll remember in an earlier remonstrance of mine that I mentioned that our property has flooded in 2019, February. We lost perfectly good horse fencing. It was 5 feet tall, about a 100-foot section, as well as the original section of fence that had been here probably dating back to the 80s when Buckinghams lived here. I used to frequent that property at that time, so I am aware of what the flood status was in this area then. I also want to mention that I spoke with an owner of May's Greenhouse, and they had not seen a flood like February of 2019 since 1965. They've lived on that property since 1965 and they've never seen water that high. So after reading some of the MS4 storm reports and also the reasoning behind increasing our stormwater fees, two of the reasons they gave were impervious surfaces being a cause and also climate change. Well, climate change is an obvious thing. Some people deny it, but it's happening. And impervious surfaces are happening in most of the developments in this area. I see that as very, very problematic. And a couple other comments I wanna make. there was something on one of the slides by Kevin Schmidt that said minimal surface environmental disruption. Well, that's just not true. Anytime you bring in heavy equipment and roll it over pasture, you compact the soil. And that creates an impervious soil. So that's just not true. And I want to say there's some other things that have been said that are just not true. We've never had 4 to 5 hour time with the petitioners. It's never been over 2.5 hours total. I also want to add that these remonstrances were not submitted prior to our discussions with them. Actually, they came after. They have not given us any assurances to anything, nothing that was believable anyway. And I'm also going to add that I submitted, I don't know, to them, my husband and I did, probably, I don't know, 10, 12 questions regarding HOA covenants, just simple things to kind of relieve our anxiety. And one of them was, for example, will there be a covenant for open burning? Well, what their answer was, and this is what most of their answers were.
Patty, I'm sorry to cut you off here. You have the 3 minutes, but we'll follow up with you after today's meeting and maybe we can facilitate the HOA questions to the petitioners.
Thank you, Jackie.
So Eve Cusack is here and she would like to speak.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
I also live on South Victor Pike, adjacent to the property in question, and I have heard my neighbors state most of my concerns. I wanted to just mention one more, that my husband and I both travel to Bloomington every day. We're school teachers in Bloomington, and we've seen the traffic grow through the development of some of the other neighboring areas, and the Lighthouse Christian School on the corner has increased the traffic a lot. I'm very concerned. I was already concerned about a 44-acre property going up for sale that might lead to 45 new homes next door, and thus, you know, 45 to 90 cars traveling at rush hour during that time when we're trying to get to work as well. And the idea of that number possibly tripling to a four-way stop at the top of our road that's not set up, and it doesn't sound like from the plans I've seen tonight that there's anything being done about that situation. And then I heard from another discussion earlier tonight about the four-way stop possibly going in at Rogers and that road, which again, when you're talking about another, you know, 100 cars possibly, four-way stop sounds kind of nightmarish. And anyway, I'm just concerned about what that additional traffic will do to our neighborhood, in addition to the idea of course, 7 years of construction going on right next door. And for all the people who enjoy using the rail trail throughout all year round. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Eve. I was muted. I'm sorry.
Oh, you're good. Thank
you. Mr. Butler, would you like to speak?
I think Daniel is part of the petition, and this is still for remonstrance. Right.
Okay.
Just as a point of order. I was going to have Ms. Thetonia mention, she wanted to bring up a point about the drainage if she's still on. Yes.
Kelsey. Yes, thank you. This is Kelsey. I just wanted to clarify information about what we're considering the 100-year storm event. So in our stormwater drainage ordinance, we have set values for what these events are supposed to be. So we have 6 inches of rainfall over a period of 24 hours is considered our 100-year storm event. Terry Kuhlman before me, and now it's in my hands. We are working very hard to update our stormwater ordinance to have the most up-to-date climate information as possible, and to make sure that newer climate trends are being reflected in the standards that we're requiring for development. It was also mentioned the February 7th, 2019 event. And I just want to clarify that when, if you're comparing that to the 24-hour, 100-year storm of 6 inches, we had over 5 inches in just a period of a few hours on top of fully saturated soils. It was a very extreme event. Was not your 24-hour, 6 inches of rainfall. It happened much quicker. So that would define it as something much more extreme. And I stand by my comments that you have to include some level of risk when you're designing stormwater infrastructure due to the cost. It could be astronomical to try and design your stormwater system for such extreme rain events. So thank you.
Thank you, Kelsey. Thank you. And I return now to the members of the Plan Commission for further discussion of this item.
I think, Margaret, if there's anyone, there might be a few others that have remonstrance.
Oh, there are?
We'll just double check and do a final call since there's 71 participants on tonight's call. So. Yeah. I'm not seeing anyone.
Okay, so let's bring it back to the members of the Plan Commission for further discussion.
Jeff?
Oh, I guess I just would like to hear if the petitioner has any comments, since several of the members of the public raised some very important points. And I guess I'd like to hear if the petitioner has any comments in response.
This is Daniel with Bynum Faneuil. If I could, I have a couple of follow-ups to just some of the comments, just some answers to some questions, if I may.
Yes, please, Mr. Butler.
I think someone asked about the acreage on the northeast that would be dedicated to park. I have that acreage for you. That's 2.5 acres. That acreage does not include the drainage area up there, and that does not include the strip of land that would be north of that area. So that would be just in the immediate park area, and that's 2.5 acres. So I heard that question, wanted to respond to that. Just so you know, we are protecting a wetland. I'm sure you guys have walked this property by now. And there is a neat little wetland that we're going to be preserving and cleansing the water that would go to that. And we'll be using that as part of the park kind of area, but just to the north of it, just a heads up that that's all going to be conserved. The other piece that I just wanted to mention was the rate at which I heard that there was going to be a lot of stormwater that'd be held back and you'd need a certain size of basin. So the calculations that we've done and were approved by the drainage board that we went through and provided them different calculations, actually went to 3 different meetings with them to make sure that we got everything that they wanted. We were approved there and we did not receive any variances. So everything that we are doing on site would be per code. In fact, they just approved, as you well know, for the Red Hawk development project, they approved a new drainage ordinance within critical watersheds. So this would restrict us to very minimal amount of new runoff rates coming off of the site. And that's why we're so low coming off of this site, because of that new ordinance that you're probably aware of. And that's why we are indeed going to restrict this to 4 times less than what would be flowing off of it now. And that is correct, that even though impervious area is added, we are still restricting it way down because, and we do understand this, that there is flooding downstream. We can't totally solve that, but we can do our part with this development. That's why we're restricting it so low. And I think that's all I want to add right now. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Butler. Mr. Enright Randolph.
I just kind of wanted to follow up on some of the drainage discussion. I know that there is a huge push to move away from saying 100-year flood event to a 1% chance. I think that should be something we strive to do, because I think the idea of it only occurs 100 years is a little misleading. So I just want to kind of echo that. It's been kind of a discussion point across the state with a lot of experts that deal with drainage.
Thank you. Thank you. I'd like to just reassert my concerns about homeowner association responsibility for drainage, especially on fragile land. And as there is pressure for us to build increasingly dense housing developments on fragile land, I think we risk placing our fellow community members at high risk of complete financial devastation. That I don't think that this is a good approach. One of the reasons why homeowners associations are necessary is because perhaps the adequate city and municipal infrastructure doesn't exist. And we do live in the county. This is not a city property. And so I would like to dissuade us from such intense uses on fragile lands. The one home per acre sounds a lot more reasonable to me than 167 individual lots with homeowner association responsibility for some of the big ticket items. And I don't think it's fair if in the name of affordable housing or approachable housing, we force our fellow community members to place at risk their life savings for things that they would not necessarily be able to control. Homeowners associations are run by volunteers in the housing development. And I've seen homeowner association after homeowner association fall apart, especially as problems arise in the development. What happens when no one takes control over the homeowners association? Bills don't get paid. Problems don't get fixed. And again, the reason the homeowners association is needed in the first place is because we're in the county, not in the city. There's no municipal authority over which this neighborhood would be otherwise in control. So I have serious concerns about this and about this ongoing use of homeowners association because we're building too densely on properties that are not covered by the municipal tax base that protects the homeowners. So with that being said, I'm going to continue to solicit feedback or input from my fellow commissioners, and then we can have a motion.
If I may, Mr. McKim, I maybe wanted to address a few more of the things that you had asked about, if you'd like me to.
If the chair will indulge.
If you can keep it short, that would be fine.
Sure. So I guess just two pieces. One, first, Mr. Butler talked about the dog park, 2.5 acres. That's only the park in the north. That does not include the dog park or the garden. That would be in addition to that 2.5 acres. I was a little disheartened to hear some of the comments that we had not supported the neighbors from the neighbors themselves. You know, we have had four meetings with various neighbors, not all with, of course, the same neighbors. And I think every single one of the questions they have asked us, you know, within reason, we have answered. We have continued to suggest that we are more than happy to answer any questions. So I will say now, if there are any other things that they believe we have not addressed, we are more than open, and Jackie, happy to facilitate that with you. You know, the HOA is a concern for sure, and something that we are happy to continue to address.
Thank you, Mr. Schmidt. Any other comments or questions from our fellow commissioners? I can't see everybody, Jackie, so if you could help me out here.
Yeah, I don't see any other comments or questions from anyone.
Well, if that's the case, I would like to have a motion.
Dee, did you wish to make a motion?
Yeah, I want to make a motion that we go with the staff recommendation of denial until such time as everything is met that needs to be met.
Is there a second? I'd like to second that. Mr. Wilson, could you please call the roll?
Let me just clarify the motion, because there was a condition until time that everything be met. This is a recommendation in regard to a ordinance amendment to create a PUD and standards thereunder. And so we either can continue it through the resolve the any underlying issues, or you can move to deny it, period.
So
Jeff, I think we're asking the same question.
That's the other question I was going to answer. This is the first hearing.
Sure, but after there is a motion and a second, don't we bring it back to the commission for final comment? I know Dave was on here at one point, but
I can't hear you. I can't.
So, Tron, you're asking after a motion and a second, you bring it back to the plan commission. Typically, after a motion and a second, we take a vote. But Larry's point is that the motion that was made is to deny until such time that they make recommended changes. This is a recommendation to the county commissioners. So this would be a recommendation to the county commissioners of denial or to not make a vote at all, because this is a preliminary hearing.
Yeah, if I may interject, Madam President.
Yes, Mr. Pittsford.
As a point of order, I would say that this motion is out of order because of the stipulations that were placed on it. Had it simply been a motion for denial, I think it would have been in order. But I think, as voiced, I myself consider it to be an out of order motion.
Ms. Owens, would you like to revise your motion?
Yes, whatever is in order is fine with me, but I'm looking at the staff, which recommends denial, and I think we need to listen to staff. They've got their eyes on it, and they know what's going on. So if it needs to be a motion for denial, then that's the motion I'll make.
I second that motion of denial. Mr. Wilson, would you please call the roll?
If we have an approved denial, are they still entitled to a second hearing?
That's my question. This is a primary hearing. This is the first hearing. You can waive a petition and approve it. I'm not sure you can waive it and deny it. Is Dave here?
Mr. Schilling?
I've got a question.
Okay.
Madam Chairperson.
Yes, Mr. Garitas.
There are a lot of comments, a lot of input from the public, a lot of input from the Planning Commission members. Some of it was relevant, some of it isn't. My question is, why wouldn't we go ahead and afford them a second hearing like we do everybody else?
Well, we do have a motion and a second. And
agreed.
If Mr. Schilling is here and he could speak to the legality of the legal grounding of the motion in the second.
Well, I think that if you've made a motion, you have a second, you're having your discussion, take a vote. Typically you would give them a second hearing, but if you can approve on one hearing and waive, I think you could deny and waive as well. So,
okay.
Okay, so Mr. Wilson, would you please call the roll?
Well, let me add the question this. Is the motion, does it also consist of a request to waive second hearing?
No, it is not to waive the second hearing. It's to deny as the staff requested, but it is not to say we should waive a second hearing. No.
Legal opinion?
Well, I think you should either waive the second hearing and deny, waive the second hearing and approve, or move to continue this to the second hearing.
And really what I mean is the third one. We need to go to another hearing so these items can be cured.
Which means we take no vote, just like we normally do on a first meeting.
Okay, we'll have this again before us then.
Yeah. Just for the record, can we withdraw the motion so it's not sitting out there?
Motion's withdrawn.
Okay. Is it? Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. So we are moving on. Thank you for that. Bearing with us through that. I thought that we could deny it and waive the second hearing. But that being said, we'll continue to discuss that item if it comes before us again. So the next item on the agenda is it the Southern Meadows, Jackie? The 2011-PUO-04. Yes. It's the Southern Meadows Planned Unit Development Outline Plan. This is a preliminary hearing, also with a waiver of a second hearing requested. So Mr. Myers, if you would be so kind as to present.
Thank you. So this is the first time we've heard this one officially at the Plan Commission meeting. So I will go through as quickly as I can some of the details regarding this petition, as well as some of the updates that we've seen since the last Plan Commission admin meeting and PRC. So to summarize, this petition is located at the 4600 block of South College Drive. It's currently zoned medium density residential. It's in Perry Township, section 20 and 21. It's known as the Southern Meadows Planning and Development Outline Plan. It's approximately 37 acres. And originally it was approved for a preliminary plat for a major subdivision to create 98 parcels split into six phases. This was approved in January of 2020. And then it went through an amendment to permit 95 parcels, which was approved by the Plan Commission in August 18th, 2020. So of those, 90 of the lots were for single family residential use. Since then, the developer has changed the preliminary plat and the land was sold to a new petitioner who is now proposing to amend the zoning map from medium density residential to planned unit development. And their intent with this new PUD outline plan petition is to propose the construction of 95 paired townhome structures, where each townhome will sit on its own lot with its own yard and will share one wall with its neighbor. So two sides of each structure will equal 190 lots. But again, it's a not increase in structures. It's an increase in density. The petitioner states there are many aspects that are previously approved subdivision, Southern Meadows subdivision will remain the same. Some of those items include the roadways, sidewalks, water lines, sanitary sewer specifications. Those will remain the same from the previous preliminary plat that was approved for the Southern Meadows major subdivision. There's also a rail trail and offsite roadway improvements as outlined in the Southern Meadows major subdivision preliminary plat. Those will all still be built. And the proposed PUD will alter the grading of the site, adjust lot sizes and layout. It will also change the type of residential construction, i.e. the paired townhomes. And it will also update the proposed storm sewer plan and adjust the layout of the multi-use path, in addition to the incorporation of public alleys in one portion of the site that we will see when we get to the exhibits. Overall, development will be built in six phases over 5 years. So on your screen now are some of the updates that have come through comments and requests from the Plan Review Committee, as well as the Plan Commission administrative meeting. Some of those updates include an impervious lot coverage comparison between the original Southern Meadows major subdivision and the current planned unit development proposal. The draft traffic study was submitted. It was performed by the same consultant that was involved with the Clear Creek urban petition. So it's the same traffic study that we have a draft of. There a car study that was authored for the Southern Meadows Major Subdivision petition was included now in this petition. Comments from the Clear Creek Fire Department, or excuse me, Fire District, regarding the increase in density are included in this new packet and report. We are still waiting to hear back from MCCSC's thoughts on the density. The petitioner's representative has told me that they've had conversations with them, but they are still waiting on a formal response to be submitted to them. The petitioner, upon planning staff's recommendation, changed the density to 4.9 acres per, or excuse me, 4.9 units per acre. And that was because the original density that they had proposed could have technically allowed it for a even denser development. That was not their intent. So they quickly corrected that to 4.9 units per acre. They added a commitment to connect the road to South College Drive and complete improvements on Old State Road 37 as part of phase two per plan commission request to provide for the second entry access point for ingress and egress that the subdivision area would need. And they changed the front building setback back to 25 feet, which had been changed to 20 feet to accommodate the comprehensive plan, but then back to 25 feet based on plan commission recommendation. So here's the location map. South Rogers Street on the west and South College Drive on the east. Here's the current zoning map and comprehensive plan. Again, current zoning is medium density residential, and the comprehensive plan has it designated as Kua mixed residential. Here we have a comparison of the design standards between the existing MR district and the proposed PUD. So only a slight uptick in the permitted density. Minimum lot area is changed. It's decreased to 0.05. Minimum lot width is decreased as well. Maximum height is seeing an increase. Minimum front yard setback, 25 feet is in line. Side yard setback is 5 feet, with one of the side setbacks as 0 foot to accommodate the townhome paired design. Minimum rear yard setback is 20 feet. And then the minimum open space as 25%, which is for the entire PUD as defined in chapter 11. The red text here is just to show updates that have been made to this table since the last time it was seen at the admin meeting. So those are just updates. They're not necessarily values, evaluation values. Here is the newly submitted impervious area comparison between the approved Southern Meadows major subdivision and then the proposed Southern Meadows PUD. You'll see that the impervious coverage percentage does not experience change based upon this analysis submitted by the petitioner's representative. Here we have some site conditions. Site is currently vacant. There is FEMA floodplain on the site, which will be put into a common area. There's also 11 known karst areas present on the property. Those are in the yellow circles here. Some of those circles exhibit multiple karst features, and not just a singular one. And we'll have an image that will show the reported karst features as well from the study that was submitted by the petitioner. Here's just a simple slope map showing the slope grades between 12% and higher, so fairly flat. And here is the submitted environmental engineering report for the original Southern Meadows major subdivision and the analysis of where those karst features are located based on that report. This was all included in the packet as well for your review and reference. So if you have any questions on any of this, we can come back to it. Infrastructure and access, like I stated before, a decent amount of it will remain the same compared with respect to the Southern Meadows major subdivision that is already approved. There will be an incorporation of an alleyway for some of the pair townhomes that we'll see in the exhibits later on. Sidewalks are incorporated in this development. Sanitary sewer, stormwater management will be reevaluated for the new changes based on the PUD's density, as well as street lighting and other public utilities are included on site, like gas, electric, communications, etc. Here are the Monroe County Fire District comments, speaking about the increase of density and that the duplexes will need to have a full and complete firewall. They don't feel like the hydrants will need to change due to the increase in density. And then there's some other suggestions about the outside walls facing other structures. They should be designed with certain materials in mind in order to prevent fire extension from structure to structure. This information is also in the package for your review. And then down here in the bottom right, I have a little blip about MCCSC status. We're still waiting to hear from the petitioner's representative whether or not they have received a statement from MCCSC representative about the increase in density and the effect of the school systems in that area. Here we have some exhibits. This is the Southern Meadows PUD outline plan with all the pair townhomes located on the property. Within the PUD development outline plan, they do state that there is some flexibility for single family residents in the development. However, they are not displaying any at this time. They're simply displaying all pair townhomes. But they are reserving the opportunity to do single family residence in the outline plan. So keep that in mind. Here's a parking summary exhibit that breaks down the garage spaces that will be available, the driveway spaces, as well as street spaces, and a total here. We can pull up a more detailed map of this. I know it gets kind of fuzzy when we copy them over into the packet and then put them on the slideshow here, so you can get a little fuzzy. But if we want to look more detail about this, we can. The parking summary has been evaluated by the highway department, and there's been some exchange with comments there. Next slide. And then here we have the original major subdivision proposal for the Southern Meadows. So this is what was approved. You'll note that it has a lot of the Karst features outlined, as well as each of the lots distinctly noted. Again, a lot of this will remain the same. Primarily, we're looking at just an increase in density from single family lots to paired townhome lots. We did receive some letters of support that were provided to planning staff, basically talking about an excitement for families being able to own a home in the respect of a townhome paired design. This one's from Cook Medical about having some opportunity for employees to live in the community. And then some other letters of support here from BEDC, as well as BASCI, all talking about employers and the opportunity for residents and employees to have affordable housing stock in the community, as well as a support letter from BBR, Board of Realtors. And we did receive a few letters of remonstrance. This one, again, you've seen before for the Clear Creek Urban PUD. And it was a member of the public that was just concerned about the density and who the projected renters are, and the affordability of the structures in the development, as well as touching on some of the previous plan commission admin concerns that were communicated. And then another one here, speaking about some of the environmental impacts, as well as how the site will be met with all the other developments going on in the area and how it will change some of the character in the area. And just an overall concern for the high density and its impact on economics and infrastructure in the area. So overall, planning staff is withholding a recommendation at this time with the following concerns. The traffic concerns to be determined based on the traffic study's final submission in the Highway Department's review. And the request for small scale commercial use so that it is truly a PUD, but not just higher density housing. Comprehensive plan recommendations, architectural diversity and standards should be set forth to meet the comp plan. Consider including diversity of housing types. And based on the plan submitted, it appears that it will be a street tree conflict within the design. So I will now take any questions. And I will note too that I'm going to grab my charger really quickly, so I'll be off screen, but I will be able to hear everyone on my headphones. So just bear with me while I go grab my charger.
Okay, do members of the Plan Commission have questions for Mr. Myers? Mr. McKim?
Yes, thank you. Mr. Myers mentioned in referring to one of the letters of remonstrance about the nature of the renters here. And I just wanted to make sure I understood. The intention of this project is that these paired patio homes would be owner-occupied, correct? These are not intended to be owned by the developer and rented.
If Jeff, if that's a question for staff, I think that they are going to be on their own lot. So each side of the unit will be on its own lot and could be purchased outright. It would not have to be rented as a duplex on one lot would be.
Okay. Thank you. And maybe the petitioner might clarify that.
And I have a question about the vet report from Sarah Haminovich. She didn't make a recommendation there. She just identified the existence of the sinkholes. Is that correct?
Yes, I believe so. That it's just a report that's establishing where the sinkholes were evaluated and their details of
okay
of them physically.
Okay, thank you. So then, are there any other questions from members of the Plan Commission?
Yeah, I've got a quick one, Margaret.
Yes, Mr. Garitas.
Yeah, so I'm looking at the VET environmental report, and in that first paragraph it says the purpose of this evaluation was to determine if the sinkholes at the site will affect the proposed development. So maybe
she doesn't conclude anything there, Bernie. I mean, in the last
paragraph. I understand that, Margaret. All I'm saying is I'm pointing that out to the petitioner that he or she may speak to that.
Thanks. Okay, any other questions from the plan commissioners for staff?
Julie has her hand raised.
Yes, Julie.
Thank you. I just am wondering from staff if anything was done to accommodate the issue outlined on page 219 of our packet, which is street systems should be interconnected to form a block pattern. One of my concerns when we talked about this petition at the administrative meeting is that if you are on the east side of this development area and you want to go west, you basically have to walk around the block to get there. There's no pedestrian or vehicle cross traffic. There isn't a block pattern, and that has not really been addressed. Has it or has it?
That section in the analysis of comprehensive plan and comparison to the PUD proposal remains in the gray version, meaning that it does not fall in line with the comprehensive plan, stating that it needs to be created in a block pattern. I know that there's been some communication with the petitioner's representative. They feel very strongly about the design in that they like the idea of the alleyway as well as the current layout. So I'm not sure how amenable they feel to creating more of an interconnected block pattern, but we can certainly ask the petitioner or petitioner's representative to speak on that.
The other question I had relates to the VET report. It doesn't appear that any additional, there aren't any additional findings. Am I correct in that?
You are correct. I believe that that is the only page to the analysis, and that was the only thing that was submitted. There was a request from the Planning Commission at the admin meeting to see a CARS study, and I'm not sure if this is quite what they had in mind of a previous study, but it is what the petitioner submitted, and it is done by an environmental engineering firm. So this is what we have at this time.
Right. I would just ask that if this appears like an executive summary or a cover letter to something, and I would like to see the entire report. Thank you.
Mr. Stainbrook?
Oh, thank you, Margaret. It seems to me that some of our developments are cropping up just like Johnson grass here and there. And when Julie asked Julie, ask about the block pattern. I haven't seen that very often in this question of connectivity. Again, maybe instead of Johnson grass like mushrooms just coming up here and there through the county. And I don't see much of a pattern as a whole or in part as single developments. That I think that's an observation, Margaret, rather than a question. I'm sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Stainbrook. Okay, are there any other questions of staff by members of the commission?
I'm not seeing anyone, Margaret.
Okay, so now we turn to the petitioner and the petitioner's representative to make your case to the plan commission.
Hi, this is Katie Stein again with Smith Design Group. I also have Tom Weininger here and a couple of his staff members here as well that will speak after I do. Just real briefly touching on stuff what Drew had already mentioned that we have with this design is essentially the same design that we had with the Southern Meadows petition that was approved back in 19 or 20, the previously approved preliminary plat. With, of course, we've got some pocket parks, things like that, that Tom has incorporated into this design. Drainage patterns, you know, those have all been the same. We've incorporated the alleys in here. And then with that, I will let Tom speak and his group speak. But I know, Jackie, I had just sent you an email with a PowerPoint presentation. I don't know if you're able to share that or if I can share my screen so that they can walk through that at all.
Okay, yep, let me pull that.
Okay, thank you. And then I will hand it over to Tom and his crew.
Hello, my name is Tom Weininger. Just want to talk a little bit about myself. Third generation builder developer. My family and I have built several neighborhoods throughout the Monroe County community. Wick, Highland Park Estates, Renwick, Quail Ridge, Windermere Woods. That's just a few. That just touches the tip of the iceberg. But we're a part of this community and we build a lot of good products we're all proud of. And so now what I would like to do is build workforce housing for the next generation and hopefully build something that the next generation could afford under $250,000 and they could be a part of this community. And it's a great community. Like I said, we've been here three generations and I love it here. So let's see. And as of today, we checked, and there's one home for sale, a year or newer, under $250,000. And with Cook hiring Pete Yonkman, can probably talk more to it than I can, but I think they're wanting to hire 300 people in the next year. And Catlin, they want to hire 500. That's not to mention Baxter, IU Health, and we just have a critical shortage of housing. And there's nothing for the workforce, nothing for that young couple that could afford a house. And I'm looking to do that. I really want to do this. And so I'd like to invite all you out to WIC. It's another project we did. It's kind of a genesis of this. It's a little different in that it is for rent, but you can see it. It's built just north of the Highlands, and it's a neighborhood feel. But it was the genesis of this plan and coming together, and its density is about 6 units per acre. And the one we're proposing on this is 4.9. So, like I said, I just want to leave this community better than I found it. And I appreciate your time. Appreciate everything. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Winokur. Is there any other member of the petitioner's team who would like to speak?
Yeah, good evening. My name is Holland Knightenhelser. I've been in Monroe County for 16 years. IU graduate. I am a recent addition to the staff in Mr. Weiner's office, and I'm actually able to speak, thanks to you all. Tom's allowing me to speak on behalf of the project and on his behalf at my request. And I think that my few minutes I'm afforded to talk would really be best spent just trying to kind of highlight the genesis of the project and the motivation behind it. I've known Tom for years, but like I said, I'm new to his staff, and I'm quite privileged to be working around him. He demonstrates high quality and integrity in everything he does. And he has a motto that he believes we should leave this world better than we found it. And here we are. He wants to take his years of experience in the construction industry and all the knowledge he's amassed and do some good with it. He wants to give back, like he says, and he wants to do that in the form of this SOMO project, through which our intention is to provide homes for sale under $250,000 for the local workforce. And by, workforce and workforce housing, we mean under $250,000, which we've talked to People's State Bank representatives recently, and an individual who earns $18, $19 an hour can probably, if they're diligent, reach out and cross that threshold of home ownership at these prices. And that's our goal. And we're trying to do it in a way that is really amenable to the community and actually will help in towards the creation of a more robust community in the area. With our idea here in the SOMO neighborhood, we intend on providing walkable streetscapes with sidewalks and lighting. There's going to be connection to the multi-use trail that runs through town, connection to Clear Creek Elementary. Of course, there's the library, I believe, which will be going in to the north there near Gordon Pike. And not to mention all the commerce nearby. We're just minutes from South Walnut Street and a hub at which a lot of progress can take place. So some concerns have been raised, and I believe that the hurdles in our way are quite minimal. A lot of the concerns that have been raised, we have been able to address, at least with, to the point where I think the benefits far outweigh the uncertainty, as no project is perfect. We've done the traffic study, and we believe that there's not too many issues there. Of course, we have to be realists, and a new home does mean that probably a new car on the road. We've done the geological survey, and we think we're in good standing there. The impervious surface comparison by our findings, the runoff situation will actually be slightly better, after we provide this community and its infrastructure. Of course, we can't solve any problems conclusively, but we can certainly do our part to make sure that things are done correctly and that we're in better shape for the future. One concern that has been raised a number of times is that there might be a lack of variety in the neighborhood. Some have looked at the proposed plat and seen a lot of properties in very straight lines. And we want to give the community and everyone here our word that our intention is to create a neighborhood not only of the highest quality, but also aesthetics as well. Internally, and I believe one of the slides we've seen, actually a handful of the slides, that might be ticking past the screen right now kind of show our idea that we're working towards as far as creating variety. We do intend on having a variety of setbacks. We're working on proposing the units to have a shift in them, maybe a 2-foot shift between units. So there's some variety in the breakups of the lines. We have, I believe, 3 working blueprints through which we will demonstrate 3 sets of exteriors, kind of variation to the external facades. Of course, we're going to do our best to provide quality, and that means we're going to stick with high-quality materials, stone on the outside, granite countertops inside, and high-quality, you know, appliances and mechanics inside, because part of helping out this generation, helping these people kind of overcome the threshold into entry to home ownership, means that we have to provide them something that will last and something that's going to contribute to their future and not cause them any duress in the near future. And then again, I'm sorry, coming back, circling to the idea of variation, you know, by our calculations and what we're planning on now with the amount of exteriors and floor plans that we'll provide, of course, options for single car garage, we might offer units without those if that is allowed. And the reason we would do that would simply to be to offer ourselves further to the budget of anyone who might, you know, really be trying to get up into home ownership. But we plan on providing a really nice looking neighborhood with a lot of variety, up to 15 permutations of you know, color styles and variations as far as roof lines and elevations and setback. And again, you know, we are trying to help the workforce here sell these homes, all of them, for under $250,000 of the highest quality, built to last. We really firmly believe that this is the right thing to do because we are doing our best to respond to a need. We're trying to provide a solution to a public issue that we see, and that is, you know, attainable, what we're calling affordable, under $250,000 homes for the people who need it so that we can continue to thrive and build our county. This is a new idea. You know, this is not something you see. You know, this might make some people who look at it initially feel a bit uncomfortable, you know, and I would remind people who are having those thoughts or maybe experiencing a bit of doubt that every decision we have made going into this project has been focused on and working towards our keeping the price point under $250,000 so that we can provide something to the marketplace that is essentially unheard of at this point in time. We believe we can make a difference. So in essence, I suppose what we're doing here is we're really asking the community and everyone in attendance here, and I apologize, I'm going to break just for a minute for anyone looking at these. These are just renderings. We have to kind of conceptualize our idea. And we do feel that they represent what we're working towards fairly well. But back to it, you know, what we're doing here, we're trying to, you know, get everyone in the community on board. And we're basically asking permission and asking you all to join us in being champions of progress. You know, we see this as a real opportunity, and with interest rates at an all-time low, you know, we feel privileged to be in our position at this juncture in time. And we're hoping that, you know, enough people here feel as we do and would like to put their name on the project. And I think that's all I have at the moment. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your comments. Okay. I think that... I should ask members of the commission if you have any questions for the petitioner.
Mr. Jerry and, oh, yep, Bernie and Jerry, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. I've heard the estimated price point, but what I want to hear from the petitioner is an answer to one or two questions. The first one would be, based on that price that you're throwing out there, have you already done your materials takeoff list? Do you have a cost analysis that says you can actually deliver this product for $250,000 or less?
Yes, sir. We update them every quarter, all our quantities and numbers on all our products, and to keep all our, you know, of course, we're building right now in Highland Park Estates and WIC projects. So we update all our numbers every 90 days. So
okay,
very comfortable to meet that under $250,000.
Okay, good. So what's your estimated building cost per square foot versus your list price per square foot?
You want DCCs per square foot to sale price?
Yeah. Yeah, you've got your material. So what's your estimated building cost per square foot?
Well, if you're just talking you know, of course, there's direct construction costs, and then you have indirect construction costs, ICCs, interest carry, professional fees, and then you have commissions, and, you know, people have to make money and get paid. So you're just talking about bricks and sticks.
Give me the full boat since you offered it.
Well, I mean, what we're going to do is we'll make 10%. That's it.
Okay.
Pay commissions, pay everybody. And that's what I will, you know.
Okay. So just give me your building cost per square foot.
Well, yeah, work backwards, but it's under $100 per square foot.
Okay.
And I feel fairly comfortable after three generations of building. I got it figured out.
I'm not doubting your acumen. I just want numbers.
Okay.
So what's the list price per square foot?
It's about 1,500 square foot. So divide it out. I don't know. Okay, I don't have a calculator in front of me. What is it? 166.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Garitas?
Bernie, you're on mute.
Pardon me, I get into the packet and then I don't turn it back off, so I do apologize. So that was an interesting question. So, but does that include your carrying costs on the development?
Yes, sir. I have two CPAs on staff and they calculate all that.
Right. So going to the site, looking at the cars, it looks to me that you're actually pushing the buildings that are around the karst features away. Am I reading the plan right, that you're actually increasing the distance from the karst features that are listed on the site?
Yeah.
Like at 20 and 21, 107 and 106, and then 109 and 108. The numbers are hard to read on the plat, but it looked like we were separating that a little bit more than the original plan.
We're unmuted.
We're unmuted. Okay. We're separated past the county standards, and we're using those as our green space, our pocket parks for the neighborhood.
Okay. And then looking at this, the grading doesn't really change. The footprint of impervious surface for the roadways, the buildings, I know that's in the report, but all that is comparable to what the original plan was. Is that right?
Impervious is slightly less, yes. And the roads, okay, we kept those the same except for the alleyway, we added it. But that's kind of what I was trying to do, was just to keep it simple. And the fact that we didn't reinvent the wheel, that it's approved for 90 single family homes, and we kind of kept the layout the same, just in order to get it to where the workforce can afford it, we need density. And so
what I was trying to understand with the affordable housing concept, if you look at most of the inputs, your grading is going to stay the same as what the original, compared to the original plan. Your infrastructure, roads, sewer, water, all that's going to be pretty much the same. the square footage of the rooftops is pretty much the same. And that's how your math works out for reducing the number of houses, because the infrastructure inputs pretty much stay the same. And then you're able to bring it down because you're selling more houses. Essentially, yeah, that's what you're trying to do here.
Double the factor, basically. And I'll share it with you. I mean, it's public knowledge. Yeah. The ground was $1.9 million. You know, Stanger Excavating gave me a price, which they've done on my excavating for me on WIC,
yeah,
which is already up.
Hey, Tom, Tom, you don't have to share that with me. I'm not interested in that. I'm just looking at it.
Yep. It's just the fact you're dividing it by.
I'm just looking at inputs and outputs.
Yep.
Okay. Are there any other questions by the Plan Commission for the petitioner?
I'm not seeing anyone.
Okay, then Mr. Figg has had his hand raised for a long time. And if it's okay, I'd like to take comments or of about 3 minutes for those in favor of the project. Mr. Figg?
Thank you, Dr. Clements. My name is Mark Figg. I'm with Figg Property Group. I also recently chaired the Bloomington Economic Development Corporation and Monroe County Apartment Association. So I'm here really to speak in favor of this project and urge you to support it. I mean, it is my business to know the numbers of Monroe County, and I've been doing it since 81. So I really like this development. I think it hits a niche that is not being hit enough, because a lot of people are not going to be able to afford a single family home that's 350 plus. You know, I participated in the Indiana Uplands Regional Housing Study in September of 19, and then the Bloomington Housing Study in May of 2020. And then we recently did a study at Monroe County Apartment Association that resoundingly states that we're full. We have full occupancy, actually 97%, 98% in the southern area. That's for rental. It's also an indicator of houses for sale. And that's already been alluded to in previous development proposals tonight. So I won't heap on there, but population growth equals housing growth. We've had it for a long time. You can look back at building permit numbers. We have not been building enough homes in Monroe County for a long, long time. So we really need to ramp it up to try to meet the demand. This is not a high density project at that number. I think it was 4.9. I mean, we used to have high density developments in Monroe County that were 15 to 20 units per acre. That was really common. They're still functioning fine. I would just urge that, you know, I would have the Plan Commission not worry about this oversupplying, because developers put up their money, banks loan them money, us money, to do developments, and we simply are going to build and do our own market studies and figure out what the market needs. We need a lot of options in different areas. This is one that's obviously very much in demand and has been for a long time. Not every zoned parcel is going to get built for various reasons. I mean, there are lots of examples of that. Things have been available forever. So, you know, just, I would not worry about that as a planning commission or as a board of commissioners. I would also add that, you know, this particular developer has probably the best track record in Monroe County. I know everybody in the business, you know, Weininger and all his predecessors have been rock solid. They've done some of the most pretty and interesting developments. And, you know, I know that they keep their promises, which means a whole lot in this business. So that's what I would just simply say, don't worry about overbuilding. The market will take care of itself. We're not going to ruin our market by building these townhomes down south. Thank you for your time.
Thank you so much for Mr. Figg for your comments and for your patience tonight. Mr. Yonkman, would you like to speak?
Yes, thank you. I'm Pete Yonkman. I'm president of Cook and Cook Medical and Cook Group. I felt compelled to speak in support of this project tonight after talking with Tom and hearing his vision. We work with developers all over the state of Indiana and across the country, really. And to be honest, there's a lot easier ways to make money than what he's proposing. There just aren't a lot of developers that are interested in working at this price point, and we struggle to find them. So when I heard about his passion for the project and what he was trying to accomplish, it really checked a lot of boxes for us. Just to give you an example, I know that we've talked about data a lot tonight, but we did a survey of our employees, about 1,000 of them in Monroe County, and 75% of them said they wanted to move in the next year. Of those, 80% said they did not believe they'd be able to find a home. And I just on the numbers front, we have hired already this year 300 people. Catalent has hired 1,200 people in the first 3 months of this year. So there is growth, and I think it's growth beyond what even some of the projections have said. The other thing I would say to you is we have a program at Cook. In our community, we have 25,000 people who are working age but don't have a high school diploma. And we created a program for them where they could work for us full time but go to school part of the time. We've graduated 300 people through that program now. And I have lunch with all the graduates every time, and they say two things. One is they're going back to school because they want their kids to see the importance of school, and they want to improve their families' lives. And number one on that is home ownership. And what they say is they want to be in Monroe County and they want to own a home. And so a project like this, a lot of our folks are coming from, they're either very young, first job, or they're coming back to the workforce from being chronically underemployed through this high school program. And what you hear from them is they just don't feel like they can find a home. And so I think if what we're trying to build as a community is really an inclusive community, it's these types of projects that are going to give people that first step to getting on to that path of upward mobility. And you know, the other thing I would say is that there's also been a lot of discussion on commercial properties as part of this project and whether or not they should be there. We have a unique perspective. We own a lot of commercial properties and bookings too. What we've seen is that it's very hard, even pre-pandemic, for a lot of these businesses to make it in these types of small commercial properties. There just isn't a lot of need for them. Retail is changing a lot over the last, and particularly over the last year or so. I would just, again, highlight the question around, is including commercial a viable situation for all these communities? So anyways, I just want to say thank you again to Tom and his team. Thank you for the opportunity to speak. And I really do hope you support this project. I think it's well needed for the community. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Yockman. And thank you for coming tonight and sharing your thoughts with us. Is there any other member of the community who would like to speak in favor of this project?
Tambi. Hi there. As you know, I'm Tambi Weichel Cassidy. I'm the adjoining property owner to the petitioner. And I just want to say that I was actually pretty relieved and grateful when I found out that Weiniger was purchasing that property after it had been approved for the Southern Meadows project. And I think they have a really great reputation, and I'm glad to be working adjacent to them, and I wish them all the success in their project, regardless of what that turns out to be. Thank you.
Thank you, Tambi. Is there any other member of the public who would like to speak in favor of this project?
I'm not seeing anyone.
Okay, is there any member of the public who would like to speak in opposition to this project?
I don't see anyone, Margaret.
Okay, then we bring it back to the members of the commission for further discussion and a motion.
I have a discussion point. This is, again, just our preliminary review at our Plan Commission, correct? We've only heard this at our admin meeting.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you. So I guess I would like to ask the petitioner, or at least get consideration from the Plan Commission, if we are looking to not move this forward in a favorable or a recommendation, that we continue this as well. And I guess I would like to ask the petitioner if that would be something that he would support if us as a commission aren't moving this forward with a favorable recommendation, would you want us to continue it?
So yes. John, just to clarify then, this is a preliminary hearing and they've requested a waiver of the final hearing. And so—
Right, I'm just trying to prevent from what happened last meeting, because I would always, just like we give consideration to public that remonstrate against things and sometimes waive the final hearing request, or we don't waive the final hearing request due to those concerns, I'd like to offer that same type of consideration to the developer and the petitioner. So that's it. I'm not looking to make a motion, but that's my
point. Okay, no motion has been made at this time, and Mr. Pittsford has his hand raised.
Yeah, thank you. I just wanted to make something clear. When I questioned the petitioner on the numbers, wasn't really interested in the business finances. I was just trying to wrap my brain around the idea of how you could build a house and sell it for that kind of money and make sure it wasn't a pipe dream kind of proposal. So, and I felt like the numbers he gave me were consistent with what I would like to see in terms of actually being able to carry this from design to development completion. Thank you.
Thank you. So is there a motion from any member of the commission to continue to approve, et cetera?
I would make a motion for continuing this to the next meeting, even though we don't have to have a motion, I think, in order to move things forward. Let's just continue it on. I think it needs a little more time to percolate and resonate with commission members.
Thank you. So there's no need for a vote on that.
Unless there's a motion to approve and waive.
Yes.
Unless there's a motion to waive the second hearing, it goes on automatically.
Okay, thank you. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's after 9:30, and despite the fact that there are still 61 participants in attendance, in order to continue, we have to see if the members of the Plan Commission are willing to continue to hear, X number of cases. There are still three cases left. So I'm asking
Margaret, I can make a motion that we go ahead and hear the agenda out for the evening.
Okay, thank you, Bernie. Is there a second?
Yeah, I would I would second that. And I'd also like to request that the most recent comment in the chat be read into the record, because it does pertain to the last petition that we heard. Somebody was unable to get in. So I think their comments should be read into the record, please.
Okay, the person says, I was unable to get on for being in favor. Please read comment if you can, that I have known the projects Winnegar Construction has currently and in the past completed, and they are always in the highest of quality and consideration for adjoining properties. It is greatly needed more, and I don't think that there's, I think that's the end of the comment. It is greatly needed more.
Greatly needed, more homes in the price range that they are building to offer. Highland Park Continued Estates has been in such demand because of the price range and quality that Winer Construction offers. Upgrades included their base prices.
Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you. So there's been a motion and a second to continue hearing the rest of the agenda items. Could Mr. Wilson, would you please call the roll on that?
Well, I'm sorry, just point of information. I just want to make sure I understand the motion. The motion is to continue all the remaining agenda items to the next meeting.
No, it's to continue hearing them tonight and to complete the agenda.
Okay, thank you. I just want to make sure I heard the word continue right.
Yes. Thank you for clarifying.
Okay.
It is getting late. So anyway, there's been a motion and a second to hear out the rest of the agenda items this evening. Mr. Wilson, would you please call the roll?
Can we do, in the interest of speed, can we just do this by acclamation?
Okay, yes. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed?
Aye.
Okay, Mr. Stainbrook is opposed, and who? And another person?
I'm opposed. I just got a family emergency I'm dealing with right now, so
yes,
I'm not sure I can stay.
Okay, well, those who are opposed, we have a majority to continue, so I just beg of you to do your best, and also let's try to power through at least one or two more, or let's try to power through a few others. The next item on the agenda is item number 2010-SSS-13, Herbitz Sliding Scale Subdivision Preliminary Plat Road Width Waiver Request. And this is the preliminary hearing with a waiver of a second hearing requested.
Yes, and Drew, in the interest of time, maybe we just do like a quick 3-minute slides. And then if people have questions or the public wishes to speak, we'll go back.
Thank you.
Sure. All right, so this one, Herbert Sliding Scale Subdivision Preliminary Plats, located at 4270 and 4272 East Far Road. It's in Washington Township, Section 21. It's Zone Forest Reserve. Essentially, the plat committee has voted unanimously to forward this petition to the Plan Commission, the positive recommendation. And it is a petition to subdivide two parcels into three parcels. The current petition site is 58.96 acres. That's one parcel, and a second parcel is 10.42 acres. They're both independently owned, but the owners are brothers. And they are essentially taking these two parcels and creating three lots instead of the two. There is a plat vacation. There was an original plat that was the Herbert's Minor subdivision. And they are vacating that entire plat to create this new three-lot minor subdivision. Lot one will be 60 acres and will include 14.31 acres of buildable area. Lot two will have 4.75 acres with 3.58 acres of buildable area. And lot three will have 4.32 acres and have approximately 1.68 acres of buildable area. So they will be meeting all of the standards for the sliding scale subdivision. The only thing that is driving this petition here tonight is that they requested a road width waiver. East Far Road is only 16 feet wide as designated as a minor collector. And it needs to be 18 feet in order for the sliding scale subdivision to go through the approval process. As I stated, the plat committee has unanimously voted to a positive recommendation for this petition. There is no known karst. There's no FEMA floodplain. There is an existing pond on the property that will be incorporated into one of the lots. And each of the lots will be meeting the buildable area requirements per Chapter 862. There are some existing structures on the properties. There's existing single-family residences for two of the lots. The third lot will be vacant upon its creation, and they intend to eventually build a single-family home at that location. You'll note in the staff recommendation that we did have a condition of approval in that the petitioner illustrate on the plat that proposed lot three meets 200-foot minimum lot width requirement throughout the portion of the lot that it exhibits at least 1 acre of contiguous buildable area. That condition has been met and was met at the time of the plat committee meeting, but I kept it here just for transparency. Those standards will be met now with the newest configuration of the proposed subdivision. So if anyone has any questions, please let me know. It's fairly straightforward. And can go into any details that anyone sees fit.
There any questions? Mr. Stainbrook?
Margaret, I'm hoping that under consideration of the question, that any questions or further consideration could be part of the discussion. You can rule on the, of course you can rule on the propriety of this, but I would move that we recommend or that we vote approval on the sliding scale subdivision preliminary plat and the road width waiver, with the understanding, of course, that the condition Drew shares with us has been met. So if you can make sense out of the motion, I assume.
If it's, thank you, Mr. Stainbrook. In the interest of time, that's very helpful. I would just like to turn to the public to see once if there's anyone here who is opposed to this. Jackie?
I'm not seeing anyone. I know the petitioner's representative is here.
But I think in the interest of time, Mr. Stainbrook's motion is on the table. Is there a second?
I second Mr. Stainbrook's motion.
Mr. Wilson, could you please call
the point of question real quick. Do we need to include the waiver of second hearing, our final hearing?
Mr. Stainbrook, would you like to amend your motion? Yes,
I did include that. I don't think Bernie was listening.
That just might be right, Jim. That might
be right. My second is good, too.
Okay.
Thank you, Jim.
Mr. Wilson, would you please call the roll?
Sure. Well, the motion is on to approve petition 2010-SSS-13, where with sliding scale subdivision preliminary plat, with the condition that, with the staff's conditions set forth in the plat, that the petitioner illustrated in the plat, the proposed lot three meets 200 minimum feet lot width required throughout the portion of the lot that so that exhibits at least 1 acre of contiguous buildable area. Again, a motion is to approve the waiver of second hearing and approve the preliminary plat. Bertie Yuritas?
Yes.
Jeff McKim?
Yes.
Dee Owens?
Yes.
Jerry Pitzford?
Yes.
Jim Stainbrook?
Yes.
Julie Thomas?
Yes.
Amy Thompson?
Yes.
Mark Clements?
Yes.
Tronette Ray Randolph?
Yes.
Okay. The subdivision is approved by a 9-0 vote.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your patience. The next item on the agenda is item number 2101-SPP-01, Derby Pines Major Subdivision Preliminary Plat. And this is a preliminary hearing, and they're requesting a waiver of the second hearing. So, Anne, if you're here.
Thanks, Margaret. So, the petition site is 5.34 acres, currently zoned high density residential, and it's currently used for a single family residential use. Okay, I'm gonna try to get a little, I'm trying to be smarter than my computer for a second. We'll see. Okay. So the petition site was rezoned from a state residential to high density residential 2020. The high density residential allows for a zoning of 7 residences per acre. So the property is currently located in Perry Township, section 21. It is a 23 lot preliminary plat for the single family residential development that will connect Holland Fields and Bridlewood neighborhoods. Again, currently zoned high density residential. So on the right is a quick little crop of the preliminary plat. So it's 23 lots total. 22 lots are buildable. 1 lot is for stormwater specifically, only for stormwater. 18 lots are designated as with a specific 0 foot yard, so 0 foot side yard setback. So that'd be 9 home pairings, which would be called like a paired patio home or an attached single family residence. 4 of the larger size lots are located on South Derby Drive. Those homes do not have a 0 foot setback. Those are per the rezone petition that we formerly know as the Holland Pines rezone. So the site has frontage along South Derby Drive, Holland Drive stubs on property at the northwest corner, which is at the Holland Fields neighborhood. There are no known cars. There's access to sewer and water, and the majority, and, well, no, not majority, the entire site is under 15%. So with this petition, with the preliminary PAP petition, there are two new proposed roads, one of which is a road connection from East Holland Drive, which is the cul-de-sac from Holland Fields to South Derby Drive, so a new road connection. That includes the removal of the Holland Fields cul-de-sac. Formerly, we did talk about the sidewalks on the north, on the north side of the road. I was incorrect about the last meeting. I thought there was 8 foot. I thought there would be an 8 foot side path. There are 4 foot sidewalks, and there is a new road through the addition called West Red Pine Drive. So Stormwater has been actively engaged with this petition. They have been actively involved with two drainage easements. Two drainage ponds. That's not the correct word. Two drainage areas. One is lot 12, which is the lot that's not buildable. And then one on lot, I believe it's 22? No, lot 20. There's a good majority of lot 20 that is not buildable. It's going to be in a drainage easement. And in between each paired home, there will be drainage easements. The MS4 coordinator does state that they have been working closely with the petitioner to address all comments. They don't necessarily have any concerns. So this is the overall plan. You can see West Red Pine Drive go from the proposed connection between Holland Drive and South Derby. Formerly, I had originally talked that there would be an 8 foot side path. I had thought there was an original draft. I was incorrect. The petitioners have very willingly added in the 4 foot side path. It's required, so I was happy that they did that. So they will remove the cul-de-sac, add in this the 4 foot sidewalk on the north side. West Red Pine Drive will go from the south to the east. The four lots 20, 21, 22, and 23 will be not paired townhomes. They won't just be, they'll all be single family residences, but those four will not be paired. They will not have an attached patio home style. They will be larger lots per the Holland Pines rezone. So that'll look more, a little bit more consistent as you drive the neighborhoods. And lot 13 will be the drainage easement. So overall, petitioners have met all the requests that we've asked. In the report, I originally said that the recommendation was to include the 4 foot sidewalk. Petitioners met that, so staff does give a recommendation of approval to the Planning Commission based on the findings of fact and subject to the highway and drainage engineer reports.
Thank you so much, Anne. Thank you for your patience tonight and for sticking with through all of this and everything. So I would just like to ask if there are members of the commission who have questions of Anne or of any of the planners about this project.
Jeff, you have your hand raised.
Yes. So since they're meeting all of the petitions, meeting all of the requirements, the subdivision control ordinance, and not asking for any waivers, we are legally expected to approve this. Is that correct?
Yes. There would have to be a good reason based on the ordinance to deny the request.
Thank you.
Okay, is the petitioner here, and would the petitioner like to address the Plan Commission?
Hey, this is Daniel with Bynum Faneuil. Daniel. And I'm here for any questions. I don't think there's anything to add at this time.
Thank you. Do members of the commission have questions for Mr. Butler? If there are none, are there members of the community here who would like to speak in favor of the petition with a 3-minute time limit? Jackie?
I'm not seeing anyone, Margaret.
Okay, are there members of the public who would like to speak in opposition of this petition?
I see one, Ken Buzzard.
Mr. Buzzard, if you would please speak and try to limit yourself to 3 minutes, we'd be grateful.
Absolutely, thank you. I'm actually not necessarily opposed. This is more of a question for the commission. I realize that this will be approved pending engineer and drainage. What are the conditions under which, if those are found unsatisfactory, what are the conditions upon which this will be returned to this party or where the public will be notified?
So, Mr. Buzzard, I'll try to answer your question. So you're saying if this were to be approved for a subdivision, but when they come back to do the development, they are unable to meet satisfactory standards such as drainage or other considerations. Is that correct?
Nearly. If I'm understanding correctly, what I'm reading here is that this will be, you're being asked to approve this and waive second next hearing pending the satisfactory response of those two outstanding reports. And all I'm asking is, what is the process by which those reports will be evaluated and brought back? Unless I'm misunderstanding where we are standing on this. Anne, can you clarify that perhaps?
No, I think I can jump in here real quickly. It's subject to the existing highway and drainage injury reports. They're not pending. They've been issued, and any conditions set forth in those reports would be placed upon the approved subdivision. So there, it would not come back for another hearing. It's just approved subject to those reports.
Very well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Buzzard. Is anyone else here who would like to speak in opposition to the proposal? And Jackie, if you see.
I'm not seeing anyone.
Right. Okay, we return back to the commission and for either discussion or a motion or both.
I'm ready to make a motion unless anybody has
any. Thank you, Mr. McKim. Thanks.
Case number 2101-SPP-01, Derby Pines Subdivision Preliminary Plat. I move approval of the petition based on findings of fact and subject to the highway and drainage engineer reports, and include waiver of final hearing.
Second.
Sorry.
Mr. Wilson, would you please call the roll?
I will. The motion is to approve petition number 2101-SPP-01, Derby Pines Major Subdivision Preliminary Plat. The motion includes waiver of the second hearing. A vote is to approve the subdivision. A vote in favor is a vote to approve the subdivision and waive the second hearing. Jeff McKim?
Yes.
Dee Owens?
Yes.
Jerry Pitzford?
Yes.
Jim Steinbrook?
Yes.
Julie Thomas?
Yes.
Amy Thompson?
Yes.
Mark Clements?
Yes.
Tron and Ryan Randolph?
Yes.
Bertie Geritas?
Yes.
The subdivision approved by 9-0 vote.
Okay, great. Let's move on to the North Park subdivision. And there are three cases, 2101-SPP-02, North Park Area B3, Major Subdivision Preliminary Plat, 2101-PUD-01, North Park Area B3, Lot 2 Development Plan. Then item number 2101-PUD-02, North Park Area B3, Lot 3 Development Plan for mass grading. And this is for a plat vacation of lot one in the Ted Worley addition, lots one and two amendment, 1 foot street tree waiver request, sidewalk waiver request, preliminary hearing waiver of second hearing requested. So Tammy, if you're here.
I am here. I'm not turning my camera on. My brain shuts down at 9 o'clock. So I'll do my best. And Jackie was unable to share the screen, so we'll just try to do this in tandem. Go ahead to the first slide, Jackie. This is located at 2900 West Stone Carver in Richland Township. It is part of the North Park PUD, which is on the right-hand side, and I've highlighted it in yellow. The red dot represents where IU Health EMS wants to locate. It is zoned planned unit development, North Park PUD, and the comprehensive plan has it as employment. These are some of the site conditions. This is an older photo in the left. There is no home there anymore. It was demolished several years ago. So it's essentially vacant. And I will say that I don't think you can see the power lines in this photo, but there are power lines that run along the south there on West Woodyard Road. It also maintains frontage on North Curry Pike and North Lintel Drive and sort of starts the intersection of North Stone Carver Drive. These are some aerial views of the site. So the left one kind of hones in. You can actually see those power lines now a little bit. And then the right picture just shows an overview of the entire area. Lintel Drive is actually extending more north across that ravine there at this point in time as a result of the development of that 80-bed acute hospital that was approved last year about this time. These are just a few of the Google Maps photos showing the intersection there at North Curry Pike and Lintel Drive. And the bottom picture is Lintel Drive entering into that and that is where lot one would be proposed. This is also North Lintel Drive. It's mislabeled in Google Maps. And then the intersection on the bottom right is where North Stone Carver Drive is slated to extend. This is West Woodyard Road. There is a subdivision proposed which requires that sidewalks and street trees be installed along all road frontages. The petitioner, you know, already has sidewalks along North Curry Pike and Lintel Drive, but not West Woodyard here. So they are asking for a waiver from that requirement, and then street trees as well along here. This is the Ted Worley plat that they're asking for a plat vacation from for the subdivision. And then this is the proposed plat. It is currently proposed 3 lots, and lot one will be closest to Curry Pike. It's 2.5 acres. Lot two is 3.9 acres and is slated to house the IU Health EMS Center, which will house approximately 12 ambulances inside and support staff and be a dispatch center. And then lot three is a mass grading site, sort of to help prepare the site for the IU Health Center. And technically it cannot be developed until it resubdivides ever because like the driveway access has to be 300 feet from the intersection of Lintel Drive and North Stone Carver. So it can be a mass grade project, but won't be developed in the near future if this passes. It's just the second page of the plat. There's a third page that has all the design standards. So planning staff has some issues with the preliminary plat. It's relatively good to go, with the exception of there's a road that planning staff feels should be installed as a part of the subdivision process, which would require 70-foot right-of-way dedication for North Stone Carver Drive. It would include a detailed legal description and not just a placeholder, which they're showing right now on the plat. And we also recommend that lot three be kind of separated and have a lot four also added on the east side of that 70-foot dedicated right-of-way. And along with that road, there should be a feasibility study supplied to the highway department for review. Also, in order to approve the plat, there needs to be a street tree waiver and a sidewalk waiver, and any highway and stormwater comments should also be met, which I don't think they have very many. I think they've mostly been met. So what we're at a crossroads with the subdivision is the road. On the left is the North Park road plan, and there you do see that yellow North Stone Carver Drive extension. It's a local connector road, and it triggers under the North Park ordinance when use district B, which is most everything that you see west of Highway 46, when it develops out by 50%. So they are not even anywhere near that 50%. However, the petitioner chose to do a subdivision for their project. They could have left this as an entire parcel and just done some extra landscaping, but they chose to go this subdivision route, and the subdivision route is what is triggering the street. And I've included the language here from chapter 856-11 describing that two points of ingress egress for any new development, you know, needs to be provided on the plat. So, you know, we were at the Plan Commission admin session, we had discussed this, and there were talks that maybe a written commitment would be put forth to maybe come up with a time frame for when this would be installed. And staff reviewed a draft written commitment. We had talks with the petitioner and their representatives regarding that. And at the end of all of those discussions, they withdrew their written commitments. So we have none to work with here. So along with the subdivision is the sidewalk waiver. I think staff would, if I remember correctly, staff would like to see the sidewalks installed at this time. The transportation, alternative transportation plan supports it. Also, there's going to be some construction at the intersection of West Woodyard Road and Curry Pike. They're going to be redoing the roundabouts there all next year. And there will be sidewalk stubs as a part of that project. So even though we don't see any real sidewalks along West Woodyard at this time, because I did review that and there weren't any, we do have it on the plan, and we are making kind of connectors for the future in the highway department's improvements to the road. The petitioner did supply some findings for their sidewalk waiver and street tree waiver. Hopefully you got a chance to review those. They didn't touch on the power lines. I saw the power lines, and that's what was helping me support some of the street tree waiver options. Let's see. This is open space. We did review the open space requirements as a part of the PUD. Tract B3 requires a 4.37, or at least that area does. And they've provided 1.49 in the preliminary plat. So there's more that they can still include when they develop out further. So that was the portion of the subdivision I wanted to discuss. Also, we are working on reviewing two development plans. This is the more complicated one, which is lot two. And it, staff has gone a couple of rounds of comments, and we've ironed out several things. I mean, most of the parking, we're almost done getting the landscaping approved. There is a bus terminal that we're working on still. I have, I think in a few slides, I can show all the things that we're still trying to approve with this development plan, but I don't think there's anything that would necessarily make it so staff wouldn't support it, other than you know, the subdivision is kind of the hang up here with the road not being built. And there is that alternative that they could resubmit the lot to development plan and develop the entire lot as one, which would require a different landscape plan. This is the development plan for lot 3, which is the mass grading here. And then these are the staff comments that are still outstanding for the development plan of lot 2 and lot 3. I did include here the petitioner's statement. And then we did have a few letters of remonstrance. They came from the same property, one's being bought on contract, if I recall. But they had experienced some issues in the past when I believe it was Highway 46 was being installed, and there were some major upgrades of the area, and blasting was occurring. And the blasting caused their wells to crack and had to be replaced, which was expensive and on their dime. I do have within the packet in the staff report a statement from the petitioner's engineer that they don't intend to see much blasting on the site, that if any, because they're doing the mass grading, and that should alleviate that. Now, there has not been the road study for that extension of North Stone Carver, and so I'm not sure how that would possibly impact any development on that lot, but by bringing that road down south would also bring utilities down south and would allow those folks off of West Woodyard to potentially tap into city water and possibly sewer systems, because they are currently on wells, cisterns for water supply, and septic systems out there. We have a lot of other neighbors that were chiming in, just kind of expressing their concerns also about the access to utilities and fear of flood, extra flooding and erosion issues. Plat committee met February 18th. thanks, Jackie. And then this was the plan commission summary. I think I already discussed that we were hoping that we would have some written commitments to bring here today, and there are none. So it made it difficult for staff to make a recommendation, because staff does feel that that road needs to be installed going south and have that second point of ingress egress. We did have one of the plan commissioners last admin session mentioned that it would maybe only take one bad actor to block off that intersection, and then you really are having an issue with your EMS having access. And plus, with West Woodyard Road and North Curry Pike intersection going to be under construction all next year, I don't know if that timing is going to interfere with those vehicles being able to go south. That was also a thought as well, that they'll have to take the long way around potentially. This is the highway department's comments. They are not, they have no conditions at this time. Their comments seem fairly reasonable and easy to incorporate into these final remaining approval steps. And the next is the stormwater. And again, the stormwater comments pretty much have been addressed. There's just a few minor things that need to occur unless we start opening up that discussion of building the road, and then we are opening up a full new review for this site. So the recommendation for these three petitions, you know, we are recommending denial, the waiver of final hearing. Just don't feel like this has been ironed out yet enough to make any sort of recommendation. We are withholding recommendation for everything. We do feel like there is an alternative path that if they don't want to build a road, then they should just develop the entire lot and not have a subdivision here. And that would, if, by not doing the subdivision, you would be getting rid of the street tree waiver, the sidewalk waiver, and the request to build that road to the south. So with that, what questions do you have? 10:30.
Hey, do members of the Plan Commission have any questions for staff?
I have one quick question.
Thank you, Mr. Pittsford.
So Tammy, if they go the other route, they would not be required to put in the road connection to West Woodyard, and they could proceed to build this with only one point of ingress egress. Is that correct?
That is true, actually, because it requires.
That would 50%. Be by right, of course.
Yeah, that would be by right. Mm-hmm. Because the North Park ordinance would not be triggered by developing this lot yet. It wouldn't trigger that 50% rule. It's the subdivision control ordinance that's triggering this now.
Yeah, okay. this location, I just find it difficult to believe that one point of ingress egress is suitable for this kind of structure with the purpose that it serves, but that's okay, just my opinion.
Are there any other questions for staff? If not, is the petitioner here or the petitioner's representative, and would you like to address the Plan Commission?
Margaret, this is Mike Carmen. I would like to, representing the petitioner.
Thank you, Mr. Carmen.
Brian and Fanyo, engineers, Dan Butler and Jeff Fanyo, both present, will have some of the points to address as well. So I'll be fairly limited then, and I'm going to defer to them on most of the comments. It deals with the waivers, but I wanted to comment first on the remonstrators that Tammy referred to several times. If you haven't read the statements that accompanied the kind of the signature pages to go with the remonstrators, then you need to, because I think you need to put the remonstration or the objections in context. There's really nothing about this petition that they're objecting to. They're looking for an avenue that will get them water and sewer installed out there for the benefit of their properties along Woodyard Road, where we're not proposing to develop this time in any event. And that really has nothing to do with this petition. Now, the remonstration about the concern about blasting would be certainly more universal than that issue. But the issue of they're signing on as remonstrators because they want water and sewer brought to their properties on Woodyard Road has just nothing to do with this petition. With regard to this petition, the point I do want to talk about, though, is this road connection. First, it is unfortunate. I'm sorry, Tammy, it's a little bit glib to say they just need to develop the whole parcel and then this problem goes away. Well, you saw the plan. It's only a part of this lot that is proposed for any development. To say, well, just develop the whole lot means do what? Vacant lot, develop vacant property? We're just going to the sake of doing it. The proposed subdivision is intentional. It's only a part of that lot that is subject for any intended development at this time. What would be done with the rest of the property is still owned by IU Health, is for planning and a long-term plan for IU Health down the road. They have not developed a plan for what would be next on this property, but they do have this EMS building that to get built, and we're anxious to get it moving forward. We would like to see this treated tonight, way in the final second hearing, and approval should be given tonight. So the road connection, that seems to be a problem. It is not a rule. And I'm sorry, we have to go back and look at the documents. There is no rule that requires this road connection. Now the PUD ordinance, the North Park ordinance, that there are hundreds of man hours or person hours or whatever labor term we're using these days into that. And only a couple of you were around at the time. Julie was certainly a part of that. And then I believe Bernie was at that time, but most of you were not, but it was very intentional. And
I was part of it.
Okay. But it was very intentional on the road triggers, those expensive road networks out there. And the trigger of 50% of area B being developed, it's triggering this road connection, was intentional. And nothing has changed on that.
and that there would be further subdivisions of these developed parcels was certainly known at the time. It was planned for, it was intended. To now say the subdivision ordinance requires a trigger for road construction that the ordinance did not require is not appropriate, and it's also wrong. Look at page 293 of the packet, and the report happens to quote the applicable section from section 856-11 regarding this road connection. And what it says is, whenever the area to be subdivided. I'm sorry? Okay. Whenever the area to be subdivided is to use an existing street frontage, the street shall be suitably improved as herein provided and may be required to provide a minimum of 2 points of ingress egress. It doesn't say shall, it doesn't say must, it says maybe. That now throws it back in the realm of not being a rule, but being discretionary. And Jeff, I believe Jeff Annual will address more why 2 points of ingress are not needed at this place at this time. Jerry, notwithstanding your assumption that it is, I'll let Jeff address that. But so now you're confronted with a discretionary requirement, if you call it a requirement at all, a discretionary issue, confronting an ordinance issue that says not yet. An intentional development standard that says not yet, when this 50% build out on area B, then the road requirement is, and there's no plan to build along Woodyard Road at this time that would trigger the need for this connection. So I'll let Jeff address the issue of the safety and reasonable issue of 1 point of ingress egress from this site. Jeff?
May I ask a question of Mr. Sure. Carman before we go? Sure.
Yes, sure. Mr. Pittsford.
Thank you very much. Mr. Carman, you make a point of saying that it's discretionary. Who holds the discretion there? The petitioner, the lot owner, or the plan commission?
A plan commission.
Yeah, okay. It's our discretion, not theirs, right?
Yes, my point is that it was presented to you as a rule, as a requirement, and it is not. It's not a requirement. Okay. It's not.
All right. I accept that it's not a requirement, but I would like us all then on the Plan Commission to note that this is a question that is our discretion as to whether or not we think it's necessary at this time. Thank you.
Well, before we go on to Jeff, then let me follow up that comment, Joe, because I think you also have to then, when you exercise that discretion, consider the PUD ordinance that's in place that specifically identified a threshold test of when that connection would be required. And that test is not being met yet. That's the 50% build out of area B. And we're not there. And Tammy told you, you're not going to be there for a while. So you're talking about exercising discretion in the face of a very clear adopted ordinance standard. And I think you should need to be cautious about running afoul of that. And there's good reasons that you shouldn't, but I'll defer to Jeff.
Okay. I would like to move on to the rest of the petitioner's team. And who would like to speak next?
Can you hear me? This is Jeff Fagno.
Hello, Jeff. Yes, we'd like to hear from you.
Yeah. The comment has been made about two points of ingress and egress, and there's several things that I'd like to mention here. First of all, Mike's already covered the threshold and the triggers, and Jerry was on the Plan Commission at the time, those were well thought out as when these triggers were going to cause the infrastructure needed to be installed. But in this case, if there was an accident that's blocked Curry Pike, there's currently a boulevard at the entrance. There's two lanes inbound, two lanes outbound. There is a likelihood of blocking both lanes would be unlikely. And if they were, the hospital has multiple ambulance sites throughout the county. And if there was something that blocked an accident that blocked the entrance to Curry Pike, the first responders to that accident would be from this facility. And any other calls that would be dispatched from more than likely the ambulances that are provided at the Ellisville Fire Station, a little over a mile to the west on State Road 46. are, I don't know all the locations of all the stations around Monroe County, but if one crew is called out, there's other crews that can be used to cover other emergencies. The fact that Little Drive is not extended past the entrance to Stone Carver Drive is that there's no through traffic. In fact, there's very little traffic on the on Little Drive at this time. You have two users. You have the administration building that used to be the Great West building, and you have this proposed EMS building that has 20 employees. And the possibility to have lots of traffic going through if that road was through, there'd be a lot of traffic that could go through there, and the likelihood of possibilities of an accident would be much greater than it is right now, which is right now a very, very low possibility. And there are backups in the event that would occur. So the other point is that with lights and sirens, these ambulances can get through situations that other people can't. And if they're, I mean, again, the likelihood of blocking both sides of this boulevard, I think, is very limited. And if so, there's other options for ambulances throughout the county to assist in whatever emergencies there would be. This connection to Woodyard Road is about $500,000 connection. And the fact that we're developing approximately 3.5 acres of a 23-acre site would have to absorb that kind of expense at this initial phase of developing this area is not something that would be easily financed. And in fact, there's no budget for it at this time. We do need the EMS facility as a headquarters. It's going to have the administrative staff there. It's going to have dispatchers. It's going to have maintenance personnel. And it's going to have, I believe there's one or two emergency ambulance crews on site at a time. I don't have that number exactly. But trying to absorb that kind of expense at this early stage of developing this part of Area B, it's not something that is financially feasible to do. And then especially when it's, in our opinion, not really necessary to do at this time. That's what I have to say about the connections. And there could be all kinds of circumstances. If someone saw a bad actor comment, if someone wanted to be a bad actor, they'd go right to the driveway of the access to the EMS facility and they would block it right there. They wouldn't block it at Curry Pike or at the boulevards because it's such a wide intersection and four lanes of traffic would have to be blocked. So if someone wanted to do it, they would do it right there at the entry drive into the EMS, and that's secondary access to Woodyard Road would not help in that situation. I would also like to address the possibility of blasting. In page 296 of the staff report, they talk about that this site had been used as a fill site, and that's actually incorrect. This site is in situ soils that were there since time immemorial. When we built Little Drive is actually in cut, and there's approximately the maximum cut we had in there was 23 feet, and we did not encounter rock. When we did the soil borings for this proposed building, they took several borings at 10 feet of depth, and they terminated the boring without hitting rock. And then they had several borings at 15 feet of depth under the building. And again, they did not encounter rock. Under the building, we have approximately 2 feet of cut. On the west side of the property, where the parking lot is, we have about 4 to 5 feet of cut. And then where we have some retention areas, there is about 8 or 9 feet of cut. So we're not going to be close to rock. There's not going to be a necessity of blasting unless we're really unlucky, but I don't anticipate that. When we're cutting at 23 feet to build a little drive and not hit rock, we should not encounter rock on this site, and blasting would not be necessary. I'll be happy to answer any questions you might have regarding the access or blasting or anything about the site.
Thank you, Mr. Fanyo. I think we should continue hearing from the petitioner before we have questions from the commission to the petitioner. Is there another member of your team who would like to address the plan commission? Or is that it?
We can address the fact that we've been to drainage board and on the drainage issues. We're going to provide stormwater retention per the county requirements as we always have. So I don't think those other issues are really relevant there. I believe they've been dealt with, but we can discuss in detail. But in trying to save time, we'll just leave it up to questions from the plan commission.
Thank you, Mr. Fanyo. Do any members of the Plan Commission have questions for the petitioner?
Like Julie, Bernie, Tron, then Jeff. So we'll start with Julie.
I think Tron was before me, if that's all right.
Okay, Tron?
Sure, and I just am gonna be super brief. It's getting late, and I thank everyone's patience too. One thing I want to address was some of Michael Carmen's points. They proceeded down a path where it needs 2 points of ingress. Yes, the language does stipulate that it may be needed. And yes, it may be more of a subjective thing, but that does fall with the realm of the plan commission. And the way that you kind of picked it apart, you almost kind of said it's unnecessary. Or what have you nots. I don't appreciate that. I think you do a fabulous job of building your case, but that right there is just unnecessary. Because if you were defending us, you would say, yes, it's the plans commission's legal right to use their discretionary measures. So I'm glad Jerry stopped you to correct that. But I do appreciate everything you do, Michael. Jeff spoke very clear to a lot of points, I think, that do shed some light to this. And I do appreciate that. But one thing, again, that I'm not too pleased about is we've been hammered about the urgency of this. And now we're hearing that, oh, well, they can just dispatch from this area and that area and this area and that area. Well, what happened to the urgency of getting this done? That's, again, a little just kind of, you know, giving us, I don't know, the glaze on the donut instead of how it was cooked, you know. So those are just my comments. I'm a little deterred about that. And then the one other comment that these are all, you know, people with vehicles that have emergency lights. Now, we spoke to the dispatch. The people that are going to work every day aren't necessarily driving those vehicles. And it's important for them to get to the location as well. So I do believe that there were some points that were made that I appreciate a lot more. That does give me a second thought about how I might determine my decision on here. But I just wanted to point those out. And it might be the late hour, but you know, I think everyone gets the idea who I am, and I would have probably pointed those out irregardless.
Okay, Bernie's next.
Yeah, I've got to cycle through this because I don't think we're as far apart from the petitioner as what maybe we think we are. The way I understand the ordinance, it says, the PUD, it says that once that 50% threshold is built, a roadway has to be built. Am I correct?
That's correct.
Okay. So nobody's saying that the roadway is not going to be built. It's a matter of timing. Am I correct about that?
Yes.
So the only way that the road will not be built is if a petitioner comes back to this behemoth North Park and says, we want to do an amendment to the PUD. Is that correct?
Or if the B tracks don't ever hit the 50% threshold.
Right, but then that's still a threshold that an amendment wouldn't be required. So I'm just looking at if the requirement goes away or not.
Yeah.
Because I look at what's remaining on that lot, and there's a lot of property there. And I really hate to look at tying that property up for, because something else is going to want to go in there and go ahead and build the road now and forever leave an imprint that doesn't use the most efficient use of the parcel for what the uses may be in the future. I mean, does that resonate with anybody at all?
It does with me, Bernie. It does with me because it seems like a common sense, you know, solution.
And I think that IU Health, I think they know their business, and I know where staff is coming from, respect it, but there is a way to work around that because it isn't a hard, fast requirement now. It is a hard, fast requirement in the future. But when I look at that corridor that goes through there, that was really just an indication that there'll be a road there at some point. I don't think anybody's not agreeing that that road needs to be in there, but I think that lot three or that big lot to the south is, there's just a lot of potential there that we don't know what that road needs to be. And I think that we need to let it bake a little bit, rely on IU's professionalism and the engineer that says that. And I didn't look at it until Mr. Faneuil had mentioned the way the boulevard is designed out on Curry Pike. But I mean, I don't have any heartburn over this. I think that everybody's goals can be met. So that's all I've got to say.
Bernie, I'd like to say that I appreciate your comments and I find what you say very compelling. And like you, I hadn't thought about the boulevard concept until Mr. Faneuil mentioned that tonight. And that is reassuring to me from my perspective since I introduced the concern. I think it's still a concern, but with the possibility of future development coming more rapidly than maybe what we anticipate, those fears can be put on hold, I suppose.
Thank you, Mr. Pittsford. Commissioner Thomas.
I think I just wanted to hear from Mr. Schilling or Mr. Wilson, your perspectives on how this is being read.
Well, again, we don't have to impose the second ingress in regard to subdivision approval. We don't have to. I think the other concern is when and if the road will be put through. But if you feel comfortable that the subdivision would be safe with one means of ingress and egress, you could not require the second ingress and egress. Dave, do you have any thoughts? Dave?
Dave, if you are on the phone, it's *6 to unmute.
Dave's not here.
He is here, but I think we'll just have to come back to him. Oh, there he is. Okay.
How about now?
Yep, we can hear you now.
Okay. I agree with Larry and the way that's been portrayed. It's up to the Plan Commission.
Okay, and I see Dee's hand is raised.
Yeah, question. If indeed when you get to the 50% threshold, that road has to be built, who then builds it?
Good question, Dee. Yeah, that's part of staff's consideration with requiring right now is that IU Health owns these tracks that are proposed to be subdivided. But if someone else in the North Park ordinance, not necessarily IU, has to hit that 50%, they need to then dedicate the right of way and build the road at that time through this property.
And they being whoever owns that piece of property?
Whoever hits the 50% threshold anywhere in B3. It doesn't have to be IU Health.
I was just thinking if IU Health has to build the road eventually, wouldn't it be cheaper to build it now?
I think the answer is, I think, like, staff is concerned is there's no guarantee this road will ever be built. I mean, because there's no incentive to finish the project. Once you get to a certain point, it becomes more expensive to build the road than what you can make from developing the remnant.
Thank you.
Mr. McKim?
I certainly don't have a problem with moving forward without the road. I think the case has been quite compelling and extensively argued. Mr. Fanyo, I apologize if I missed this. My sound glitched for about the last 2 minutes of your presentation. Did you address the sidewalk waiver at all, and whether or not your points, your thoughts have changed on that when presented with the plans for the roundabout and Woodyard Road?
Well, when I was looking at that roundabout, it looks like there's about 1,500 feet from the intersection, current intersection now, and our west property line. And I'm guessing that the roundabout's not going to go any further than Pioneer Lane, although I don't know if it's going to go that far or not. I haven't seen the plans. But there's still going to be a 900-foot length of a gap between Pioneer Lane and our west property line. So it's not going to be an actual connection. There's going to be 900 feet of gap whenever we do build our sidewalk. Now, the problem we have is, and we might be able to get around it, but the Duke Energy does not allow you to run parallel with their easements. And they have an easement from the current right-of-way 100 feet into the property. They do let us cross it. So exactly where we would put that sidewalk is kind of up in question until we have a development plan for that area. And I do know that there are master planning processes going on for the property there. And we will know what's going on at some time in the future, but we don't know what's going to happen right now. Now, there might be another way of building that sidewalk where we wouldn't have to be underneath the power line, but until I know what the use of that land is going to be, it's kind of difficult to say this is where that sidewalk ought to be.
That's a fair response. Thank you.
I felt since we've begun discussing this project that, a lot of common sense is going to need to prevail. There are, practical difficulties like the power lines and the staging of the progression of the project, et cetera. And I think as scary as it is, there are times when common sense must prevail, and Bernie gave us a way. I don't know how everybody feels about that, but I always appreciate it when Bernie weighs in with his common sense, I think the question is, for me, is do we approve it or do we continue it so that we can think about it? For me, those are the questions. And I'm gonna defer to everyone else here on the commission. As far as what you feel most comfortable with, I take staff's recommendation very seriously, but I feel like we do need common sense to prevail.
Margaret, may I make a comment on the sidewalk waiver real quickly,
yes,
please?
Yes.
Yeah. Hey, this is in my area, not like directly in my area, but I've grown up traversing Woodyard Road quite frequently as a kid and all that stuff. And I will tell you that I don't think you could build a sidewalk in any form or fashion that would cause me to want to walk along West Woodyard Road in any time of day or night. I don't think there's any way you can build one that somebody'd say, yeah, heck, that'd be a good idea. Let's walk down Woodyard.
Thank you, Mr. Pittsford. I agree with you. Mr. McKim?
Madam Chair, you presented two options. And I think there's also a halfway point. We could continue it to the the admin session as we did with another meeting and hold the final hearing then. If we wanted to have a little bit more time to think about it, given that it's 11 o'clock at night, and not delay the petitioner that much. I'm just suggesting, I'm actually probably satisfied with it as is.
Hey, but Johnny.
I agree with Jeff that if we don't move it with a positive recommendation, we move it to the admin so we don't stack our next meeting like this.
Yeah, hey, I'm prepared to make a motion, please.
Okay, great, Mr. Pittsford.
Margaret, sorry, just real fast. We might have missed this because I ran to the restroom. Did we ask for any remonstrance?
Oh, no, we did not. Thank you.
Okay.
Are there members of the public who would like to speak in favor of this petition?
Not seeing anyone.
Are there members of the public who would like to speak in opposition to this petition?
Mitch Kyle, you unmuted?
Mitch Kyle, I am here.
Okay, would you like to speak?
Yes, I work with Tammy and she did a really great job. And I actually, she spoke about the apartments that I took over from my uncle and people that live more south down the hill on Woodyard Road. And regarding us fighting to get city water and city sewer, that is not what we're fighting for. We're not fighting anything. We are more than happy to have an ambulance garage and something closer to Ellettsville. I've grown up here and grown up here all my life. But what we're worried about is there's multiple people that live downhill directly from where they're developing that, and they've lost sewers, wells, you know, and anybody that has to deal with that, that's $10,000 a pop, you know. And I've heard a lot of people talking about people wanting to build affordable housing in Bloomington and people being comfortable to live. And there's nothing more uncomfortable than thinking everything's okay and waking up and realizing that your well's gone dry and you got to spend $10,000. So I would just ask the county to ensure that nothing affects us downhill, and that you would take care of us. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Mr. Kyle. Are there any other members of the public who would like to speak in opposition to this project?
I'm not seeing anyone, Margaret.
Okay, back to Mr. Pittsford.
I have a question for legal real quickly before I make my motion. In light of Mr. Kyle's comments, my question would be, is there any way, and I assume that there's not, that we could put a condition on this, because it's not a condition, it's not an approval, it's a recommendation for approval. Is that correct?
All your recommendations for approval can include conditions.
Okay, could a condition be included that would make a petitioner liable for any damage to wells in the that result from blasting that's demonstrable?
I think that liability exists without any condition.
Okay, I was going to say, I thought so too. I just wanted to be clear. I didn't want him to think that we were disregarding his concern, because I feel like there's civil action there if you can demonstrate that the consequence. I find it difficult to believe that there was no legal pursuit during the construction of 6946 that resulted in the failure of a well that didn't have some sort of lawsuit against the road developer, but that was just my assumption. So I wanted to be clear on that. Thank you.
I just wonder, you mentioned, you know, I would hate to have the people who lost their well have to pay the expenses of legal, you know, of lawyers. So is there a way to mitigate that in the condition?
Well, I guess I don't believe that you can, and it would be an expensive and difficult proposition to make that proof.
Right. You see, my guess would be that you'd be asking them to assume liability without demonstration of cause, which I think would be unfair. So I think if something like that were to happen, then you just have to sue for damages and legal expenses and, you know, have a compelling case. The more I thought about it after asking the question is like, we're asking them to assume liability before they actually do anything, if we make that a condition of approval. And I really don't think that would stand up legally. Would you agree, Dave?
Yeah, I think that would not be something that would be related to your duties or your land use considerations.
Right. I also don't believe it would insulate the affected parties from the possibility of cost. I mean, we could say we're asking the petitioner to assume liability, but number one, we don't have standing, and number two, it removes the burden of proof on the affected party, which I don't think would have any legal standing in a court.
For every petition, then. I mean,
I've never put a condition on anything that required the petitioner to assume liability for acts that have not occurred. Does that make sense, Jeff?
Yeah. Okay. So,
with that said, in cases numbered 2101-SPP-02. North Park Area B3 Preliminary Plat, which is a request for waiver of final hearing, a request for street tree waiver, request for sidewalk waiver, and a plat vacation of lot number one from the Ted Worley addition, lots one and two, amendment to that one final plat. Case number 2101-PUD-01, development plan, lot two, IU Health EMS, and 2101-PUD-02, development plan for lot three for mass grading. I move that we grant a waiver of final hearing, that we recommend approval based on the findings of fact and subject to the highway and drainage engineer reports. I move that we recommend the plat vacation of lot one from the Ted Worley addition, lots one and two, amendment one final plat. That we recommend waiver of the street tree requirement with condition, that we recommend waiver of the sidewalk waiver request, that we recommend approval of the development plan for lot two under staff review, and that we recommend approval for development plan lot three currently under staff review. That is my motion.
Second.
Okay, in the interest of reflecting the excellent presentation Mr. Fitzroot just made, I'm just going to take a vote. A vote in favor is a vote to approve the motion for 2101-SPP-02, 2101-PUD-01, and 2101-PUD-02. Again, a vote in favor is vote to approve all three motions.
Okay.
Yes.
Just to clarify, the street tree waiver request with one condition, I believe, to expand on that one condition, and Tammy can step in if I'm wrong. I think the condition was that they would have to plant the equivalent number of street trees that would have otherwise been required elsewhere on the site as approved by staff.
I'm amenable to that as long as Bernie will include it in his second.
More than fair.
Okay.
I would like to also add that there were still some outstanding things for the development plan of lot two and lot three under exhibit six that need to be completed.
Well, then I would amend my motion to say that any outstanding development plan issues must be resolved with staff before continuing to final approval.
Where are those listed?
Yeah.
Exhibit six. It's the very last page of the packet. Okay. And in here, yeah, these are lot two and lot three.
Sorry, I hate to mess up the mojo here, but I gotta. So what page is that?
You can refer to them all as. You can refer to them.
Jerry Pittsford said that any.
What page is that, Tammy?
It's the very last page of the entire packet.
Okay.
339.
Sorry, Bernie, while you'll review that, I'll ask petitioner's representative, Mr. Fagno, if they have any issue with addressing those comments listed by staff.
I'm reading through the exhibit six myself, but I don't see.
There are nine items.
Correct.
Looks like we've covered most of them anyhow. It says provide feasibility study or a preliminary road design.
I'm only referring to the development plans, not the preliminary plat is fine, I would say.
Okay.
Let me make a suggestion. Can we remove the development plans from the motion and deal with that at the admin meeting so we can go ahead and get their subdivision approved?
I'm okay with that if petitioner is.
I'm not seeing anything in the development plan that's concerning.
Okay, well, I'm going to leave my motion as it is. Okay. With the condition that petitioner reconcile all comments and concerns listed in this report with staff before final approval is granted.
Okay, let me call the roll on all three motions. Again, a motion to a yes vote is vote to approve. The Owens?
Yes.
Jerry Pittsford?
Yes.
Jim Steenbrook?
Yes.
Julie Thomas? Amy Thompson?
Yes.
Barbara Clemens?
Yes.
Tony Ray Randolph?
Yes.
Bernie Garitas?
Yes, sir.
Jeff McKim?
Jeff, he actually went on mute.
Yeah.
Is that a yes?
Yeah.
Okay. Julie Thomas? Okay, I will show the vote as 8 in favor and 1 abstention or absent. All three motions are approved.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you, everyone. But Larry, I would like to just take a moment and to thank Larry for his good work up at the State House in adding language to a bill that prevented plan commissions from regulating timbering. And Larry, if you just would just take a few moments to tell us what you accomplished, and I'd like to thank you for your service in that and your expertise.
You know, I don't want to take any time right now, but tomorrow night, let's do this again tomorrow night. And we can do that.
Okay. Okay. And I would be remiss if I didn't ask from Mr. Schilling if he had anything he wanted to share tonight. Okay. So given that, is there a motion to adjourn?
I move to adjourn. And I also move to thank everybody for their time today. Yeah. Petitioners, public, staff, TSD, thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, everybody. See you tomorrow.